Good evening. Nice to see you all here tonight. Welcome to the 22nd production of the Savannah Lakes Village Playhouse. Began in 1996, and this year alone, we've done almost one quarter of the total productions that the Playhouse has done. We did five this year, including this one. So we're proud of that, and we thank you for your support. We're here to entertain you. We're here to make the village a greater place, if that's possible, to live, and everything that we can do to add to that, we love doing. Besides the people that you see on stage this evening, there are nearly 30 people who have contributed to this production in one way or another. Some of them have done massive amounts of work for months. And so I would encourage you to look at the back of the program, look at the names of the people and the roles that they have filled, and if you get a chance, please express some appreciation to them for their huge amount of work also. It took really more than 4 months since we started this production, because as you know, it's a little different than anything we've done before. We hope you'll like that. We'll have two short intermissions. Hopefully we can keep them down to 10 or 12 minutes because we'd like to get you home before 1 a.m. if we can. But the bar will be open. Now, there will be some short curtains in between. When the curtain closes, that doesn't mean it's another intermission. You'll know if the house lights go on. If not, please stay in your seats. Don't start running for the door. And just in case you're concerned, you know, in 1941, everybody smoked a lot. So you'll see some smoking on the stage. These are not real cigarettes and cigars. There's no real smoke. There's no real tobacco. So please don't be concerned about that. These are theatrical. I'd like to mention, too, someone after the last show said, it's really neat how you guys have these teleprompters and earphones in your ears and things. We do not. We quit using prompters on our stage here many years ago. We do not have teleprompters. We do not have earphones in our ears. Each of us has a microphone, so you can hear well. But we had to learn these lines, and so we did. Now, please, if you would all turn your phones off, because this is a ghost story, and you do not want to frighten a ghost. It doesn't work very well. Now sit back and enjoy Blithe Spirit, and thanks again for being here.
You'd better fetch the ice bucket.
Yes, Mom.
Did you manage to get the ice out of those little tin trays?
I had a bit of a struggle, but it's okay now.
And did you fill the little trays up again with water?
Yes, Mom.
Very good, Edith. You're making giant strides.
Yes, Mom.
Madame Arcati, Mrs. Bradman, and I will have our coffee in here after dinner. Mr. Condamine and Dr. Bradman will have theirs in the dining room. Is that quite clear?
Yes, Mom.
And when you're serving dinner, Edith, try to remember to do it calmly and methodically.
Yes, Mom.
As you are not in the Navy, it is unnecessary to do everything at the double.
Very good, Mom.
Now go and get the ice.
Yes, Mom.
Not at a run, Edith.
Yes, Mom.
No sign of the advancing hordes?
Not yet.
No ice.
It's coming. I've been trying to discourage Edith from being quite so fleet of foot. You mustn't mind if everything is a little slow motion tonight.
I shall welcome it. The last few days have been extremely agitating. What do you suppose induced Agnes to leave us and go and get married?
Oh, the reason was becoming increasingly obvious, dear.
Yes, but nowadays nobody thinks anything of that sort of thing. She could have popped into the cottage hospital, had it, and popped out again.
Her social life would have been seriously undermined.
Well, we must keep Edith in the house more.
That's right, Edith. Put it down on the table.
Yes, Mom.
I left my cigarette case on my dressing table. Edith, would you get it for me?
Yes, sir.
There now.
You took her by surprise.
Try martini, I think, don't you?
Oh, yes, darling. I would expect Madame Arcati will want something sweeter.
Well, we'll have this one for ourselves anyhow.
Oh, dear.
What's the matter?
I have a feeling this evening's going to be awful.
Oh, it'll probably be funny, but not awful.
You must promise not to catch my eye. If I giggle, and I'm very likely to, it will ruin everything.
But you mustn't. You must be dead serious, and if possible, a little intense. We can't hurt the old girl's feelings, however funny she is.
But why the Bradmans, darling? He's as skeptical as we are. He'll probably say the most dreadful things.
No, I've warned him. There must be more than three people, and we couldn't have invited the vicar and his wife because A, they're dreary, and B, they wouldn't probably have approved at all. So it had to be the Bradmans.
That's right, Edith.
Thank
Put it
you,
down
Edith.
On the table.
Steady does it.
Okay.
Perhaps we could have a walkabout with a book on our head as they do in deportment lessons. Here, try this.
Oh, lovely, dry as a bone.
Here's to the unseen.
I must say that's a wonderful title.
If this evening's a success, I shall start on the first draft tomorrow.
How extraordinary it is.
What?
Oh, I don't know. Being right at the beginning of something, it gives one an odd feeling.
Do you remember how I got the idea for The Light Goes Out?
Suddenly seeing that haggard, rattled woman in the hotel at the Ritz. Of course, I remember we sat up half the night talking about it.
She certainly came in very handy. I wonder who she was.
And if she knew, I mean, if she ever recognized that description of herself. Poor thing. Here's to her, anyhow.
Have another.
Oh, darling, it's most awfully strong.
Never mind.
Used Elvira to be a help to you when you were thinking something out, I mean?
Oh, every now and then she did when she concentrated, but she didn't concentrate very often.
I do wish I'd known her.
I wonder if you'd have liked her.
I'm sure I should. As you talk of her, she sounds enchanting. Yes, I'm sure I should have liked her, because as you know, I have never for an instant felt in the least jealous of her. That's a good sign.
Poor Elvira.
Does it still hurt when you think of her?
No, not really. Sometimes I almost wish it did, and I feel rather guilty.
I wonder if I died before you'd grown tired of me, if you'd forget me so soon.
What a horrible thing to say.
No, I think it's interesting.
Oh, to begin with, I haven't forgotten Elvira. I remember how fascinating she was, and how maddening. I remember how badly she played all games and how cross she got when she didn't win. I remember her gay charm when she had achieved her own way with something, and her extreme acidity when she didn't. I remember her physical attractiveness, which was tremendous, and her spiritual integrity, which was nil.
You can't remember something that was nil.
I remember how morally untidy she was.
Was she more physically attractive than I am?
Now that's a very tiresome question, my dear, and fully deserves the wrong answer.
You really are very sweet.
Thank you.
And a little naive, too.
Why?
Because you imagine that I mind about Elvira being more physically attractive than I am.
Well, I should think any woman would if it were true. But perhaps I'm old-fashioned in my view of female psychology.
Not exactly old-fashioned, darling, just a bit didactic.
How do you mean?
It's didactic to attribute to one type the defects of another type. For instance, you know perfectly well Elvira would mind terribly if you found another woman more attractive physically than she was. It doesn't necessarily follow that I would. No, Elvira was a more physical person than I am. I'm certain of that. It's all a question of degree.
I love you, my love.
I know you do, but not the wildest stretch of imagination could describe it as the first fine, careless rapture.
Would you like it to be?
Good God, no.
Oh, no. Wasn't that a shade too vehement?
We're neither of us adolescents, Charles, and we've neither of us led exactly prim lives, have we? We've both been married before. No, careless rapture at this stage would be incongruous and embarrassing.
I hope I haven't been in any way a disappointment, dear.
Don't be so idiotic.
Well, after all, your first husband is a great deal older than you, and I shouldn't like you to think that you've missed out all along the line.
There are moments, Charles, when you go too far.
Sorry, darling.
As far as Washbiz female psychology goes, there's a rather strong vein of it in you.
I've heard that said of Julius Caesar.
Julius Caesar is neither here nor there.
He may very well be, for all we know. We'll have to ask Madame Arcati.
You're awfully irritating when you're determined to be witty at all costs, almost supercilious.
That's exactly what Elvira used to say.
I'm not at all surprised. I never imagined, physically triumphant as she was, that she was entirely lacking in perception.
Darling Ruth.
There you go again.
As I think I mentioned earlier, I love you, my love.
Poor Elvira.
Didn't that light comrade, the kiss, mollify you at all?
You're annoying. You know you are. When I said poor Elvira, it came from the heart. How you must have bewildered her so horribly.
Don't I ever bewilder you at all?
Never for an instant. I know every trick.
Oh, the only thing I can say then is we'd better get a divorce immediately.
Put my glass down. That's a darling.
She certainly had a talent for living. It's a pity she died so young.
Poor Elvira.
Now that remark's growing monotonous.
Poor Charles, then.
That's better.
And later on, poor Ruth, I expect.
Oh, you have no faith, Ruth. I really do think you should try to have a little faith.
I shall strain every nerve.
Life without faith is an arid business.
How beautifully you put things, dear.
I am to please.
If I died, I wonder how long it would be before you married again.
You won't die. You're not the dying sort.
Neither was Elvira.
Actually, yes, she was when I look back upon it. She had a certain ethereal, not quite of this world quality about her. No one could call you even remotely ethereal.
Nonsense. She was of the earth, earthy.
Well, she is now, anyhow.
You know, that's the kind of observation that shocks people.
It's discouraging how many people are shocked by honesty and how few by deceit.
Write that down. You might forget it.
You underrate me.
Anyhow, it was a question of bad taste more than honesty.
I was devoted to Elvira. We were married for 5 years. She died, and I missed her very, very much. But that was 7 years ago, and I have now, with your help, my love, risen above the whole thing.
Admirable. But if tragedy should darken our lives, I still say with prophetic foreboding, poor Ruth.
Well, that must be the Bradmans.
It might be Madame Arcati.
No, she'll come on her bicycle. She always goes everywhere on her bicycle.
It really is very spirited of the old girl.
Shall I go, or should we let Edith have her fling?
Wait a moment and see what happens.
Perhaps she didn't hear.
She's probably on one knee in a pre-sprinting position waiting for cook to open the kitchen door.
Steady, Edith.
Dr. and Mrs. Bradman.
We're not late, are we? I only got back from the hospital about half an hour ago.
No, of course not. Madame Arcati's not here yet.
And that must have been her we passed coming down the hill. Well, I said I thought it was.
Then she won't be long. I'm so glad you were able to come.
We've been looking forward to it. I feel really quite excited.
I guarantee Violet will be good. I made you a promise.
There wasn't any need. I feel absolutely excited. Let me see, Madame Arcati. Two or three times in the village, and I mean, she's never done anything at all peculiar, if you know what I mean.
Dry martini.
By all means.
She certainly is a strange woman. It was only a chance remark of the vicar's about seeing her up on the knoll on Midsummer's Eve dressed in sort of Indian robes that made me realize that she was psychic at all. Then I began to make inquiries. Apparently, she's been a professional in London for years.
It's funny to think of anybody doing it as a profession.
Well, I believe it's quite lucrative.
Do you believe even in it, Mrs. Condiment? Do you think there's anything genuine about it at all?
I'm afraid not, but I do think it interesting how easily people allow themselves to be deceived.
But do you really think she believes?
I suspect the worst. A real professional charlatan. That's what I'm hoping for, anyhow. The character I have planned for my book must be a complete imposter. That's the most important factor of the whole story.
What exactly are you hoping to get from her?
Jargon, principally. Tricks of the trade. I haven't been at a seance for years, and I need to refresh my memory.
Then it's not entirely new to you.
Oh, no, not at all. When I was a little boy, an aunt of mine fancied herself a medium, and she used to go into the most elaborate trances after dinner. My mother was fascinated by it.
Was she convinced?
Oh, good heavens, no. She just naturally disliked my aunt and loved making a fool of her.
I gather that there were never any tangible results.
Well, sometimes she didn't do so badly. On one occasion, we were all sitting around in the pitch dark, with my mother groping her way through Chaminade on the piano, and my aunt suddenly let out a shrill scream. She said she saw a small black dog next to my chair. Then someone flipped on the lights, and sure enough, there it was.
Oh, but how extraordinary.
I had to take my hat off to Auntie for producing it, or I should say, utilizing it. Even Mother was a bit shaken.
But what happened to it?
It lived with us for years.
I sincerely hope Madame Arcati won't produce any livestock. We've so very little room in this house.
Do you think she tells fortunes? I love having my fortune told.
I expect so.
I once was told on the pier at Southsea that I was surrounded by lilies in a golden summer. It worried me for days.
But, you know, we really must all be serious and pretend that we believe implicitly, otherwise she won't play.
Also, she might really mind. It would be cruel to upset her.
I shall be good as gold.
Have you ever attended her doctor? Professionally, I mean.
Yes, she had influenza in January. She's only been here just over a year, you know. I must say, she was singularly unpsychic then. I always understood that she was an authoress.
Yes, we originally met as colleagues at one of Mrs. Wilmot's Sunday evenings in Sandgate.
What sort of books does she write?
Two sorts. Rather whimsical children's stories about enchanted woods filled with highly conversational flora and fauna, and enthusiastic biographies of minor royalty. Very sentimental, reverent, and extremely funny.
Here she is.
She knows, doesn't she, about tonight? You're not going to spring it on her?
Oh, no. It was all arranged last week. I told her how profoundly interested I was in anything to do with the occult, and she blossomed like a rose.
Oh, I suddenly feel quite nervous, as though I were going to make a speech.
You go and greet her, darling.
I've leaned my bike up against this little bush. It'll be perfectly all right if no one touches it.
Madame Arcati. It was so nice of you to have come all this way.
My dear Madame Arcati.
I'm afraid I'm rather late, but I had a sudden presentiment that I was going to have a puncture. So I went home to fetch my pup. And then, of course, I didn't have a puncture at all.
Well, perhaps you will on the way home.
Dr. Bradman, the man with the gentle hands.
Well, I'm delighted to see you looking so well. This is my wife.
Oh, we're old friends. We meet coming out of shops.
Would you like a cocktail?
If it's a dry martini, yes. If it's a concoction, no. Experience has taught me to be very wary of concoctions.
It is a dry martini.
Oh, how delicious. It was wonderful cycling through the woods this evening. I was deafened with birdsong.
It's been lovely all day.
Oh, but the evening's the time. Mark my words. Thank you. Cheers. Cheers.
Don't you find it very tiring bicycling everywhere?
Oh, on the contrary, it stimulates me. I was getting far too sedentary in London. That horrid old flat with the dim lights. They had to be dim, you know, the clients expect it.
I must say, I find bicycling very exhausting.
Steady rhythm, that's what counts. Once you get the knack of it, you need never look back. On you get, and away you go.
But those hills, Madame Arcati, pushing up those awful hills.
Just knack again. Down with your head and up with your heart. And you're over the top like a flash and skimming down the other side like a dragonfly. This is the best dry martini I've had for years.
Will you have another?
Oh, certainly. You're a very clever man. Anybody can write books, but it takes an artist to make a dry martini that's dry enough.
Are you writing anything nowadays, Madame Arcati?
Every morning, regular as clockwork, 7 till 1.
Is it a novel
or a memoir? It's
a
children's book. I have to finish it by the end of October in order to catch the Christmas sales. It's mostly about very small animals. The hero is a moss beetle. I had to give up my memoir on Princess Palliatani because she died last April. I talked to her the other day about it, and she implored me to go on with it, but I really haven't the heart.
You talked to her the other day about it?
Yes, through my control, of course, and She sounded very irritable. It's funny to think of people in the spirit world as being irritable. One can hardly imagine it, can one?
Yeah, but we have no reliable guarantee that the afterlife will be any less exasperating than this one, have we?
Oh, Mr. Godby, how can you?
I expect it's dreadfully ignorant of me not to know, but who was Princess Paliotani?
She was originally a Jewess from Odessa, of quite remarkable beauty. It is an accepted fact that people used to stand on their seats at railway stations just to watch her whiz by.
She was a keen traveler?
In her younger days, yes. Later on, she married a Mr. Clark from the consular service and settled down for a while.
How did she become Princess Paliotani?
Oh, that was years later. Mr. Clark passed over and left her penniless with two strapping girls.
Oh, how unpleasant.
So there was nothing for it but for her to follow the beckoning finger of adventure and take to the road again. So off she went, bag and baggage, to Vladivostok.
What an extraordinary place to go.
Oh, she had cousins there. And some years later, she met old Paliotani, who was returning from a secret mission in Japan. Oh, he was immediately staggered by her beauty and very shortly afterwards married her. From then on, her life became really interesting.
I should hardly have described it as dull before.
What happened to the girls?
She never saw them, nor spoke to them for 23 years.
But how extraordinary.
Not at all. She was always very erratic emotionally.
Dinner is served, Mom. Oh, thank you, Edith. Shall we?
No red meat, I hope.
There's meat, but I don't think it would be very red. Would you rather have an egg or something?
Oh, no, thank you. It's just that I make it a rule to never eat meat before I work. It sometimes has a rather odd effect.
What sort of effect?
Oh, nothing of the least importance. And if it isn't very red, it won't matter much. Anyhow, we'll risk it.
Come along then, Mrs. Bradman. Madame Arcati, your Aunt Charles is right.
Mother sighed, and then she went back to the Borgias, which I think accounts for a lot one way or another. Even as a child, she was given to the most violent, destructive tempers. Very inbred, you know.
Yes, she must have been.
Yes, my control was quite scared the other day when we talked. I could hear it in her voice. And after all, she's only a child.
Do you always have a child as a control?
Yes, they're generally the best. Oh, some mediums prefer Indians, of course, but I've always found them to be unreliable.
In what way unreliable?
Well, for one thing, they're frightfully lazy. And also, when faced with any sort of difficulty, they tend to go off into their own tribal language, which naturally is unintelligible, and that tends to waste a lot of time and spoil everything. No, children are undoubtedly more satisfactory, especially when they get to know you and understand your ways. Daphne's worked with me for years.
And she goes on still being a child. She doesn't show any signs of growing older.
Time values on the other side are utterly different from ours.
Does it feel funny when you go off into a trance?
In what way? Funny?
Mrs. Bradman doesn't mean funny in its comic implication. I think she meant odd or strange.
The word was an unfortunate choice.
I'm sure I'm very sorry.
Don't worry, it doesn't matter in the least. Please don't apologize.
When did you first discover you had these extraordinary powers?
When I was quite tiny. My mother was a medium before me, as you know, so I had every opportunity of starting on the ground floor, as you might say. I had my first trance when I was 4 years old, and my first ectoplasmic manifestation when I was 5 and a half. Oh, what an exciting day that was. I shall never forget it. Of course, the manifestation was quite small and a short duration, but for a child of my tender years, it was most gratifying.
Your mother must have been so pleased.
Oh, she was.
Can you foretell the future?
Certainly not. I disapprove of fortune tellers most strongly.
Oh, really? Why?
Too much fake and guesswork mixed up with it. Even when the gift is genuine, and only rarely is, you can't count on it.
Why not?
Time again. Time is the reef upon which all our frail mystic ships are wrecked.
You mean because it has never yet been proved that the past and the present and the future are not one and the same thing?
I long ago came to the conclusion that nothing has ever been definitely proved about anything.
How very wise. I want you to leave the dining room just as it is for tonight, Edith. You can clear the table in the morning.
Yes, ma'am.
And we don't want to be disturbed for any reason whatsoever for the next hour or so. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
And if anyone should telephone, just say we are out and take a message.
Unless it's an urgent call for George.
Unless it's an urgent call for Dr. Bradman.
Yes, ma'am.
There's not likely to be one, is there?
No, I don't think so. Once I am off, it won't matter. But an interruption during the preliminary stages might be disastrous.
Well, I wish the men would hurry up. I'm terribly excited.
Oh, don't be. It makes everything much, much more difficult.
Well, Madame Arcati, the time is drawing near.
Who knows? It may be receding.
How very true.
I hope you feel in the mood, Madame Arcati.
It isn't a question of mood. It's a question of concentration.
You must forgive us being impatient. We can perfectly easily wait, though, if you're not quite ready to start.
Oh, nonsense, my dear. I'm absolutely ready. Hi-ho, hi-ho, to work we go.
Is there anything you'd like us to do?
Do?
Yes, like hold hands or anything?
All in good time, Mr. Condamine. But first, a few deep, deep breaths of fresh air. You may all talk if you wish. It will not disturb me in the least.
Oh, dear.
Excellent dinner, darling. I congratulate you.
The lunch wasn't quite right.
Oh, it looked a bit hysterical, but it tasted delicious.
Oh, that cuckoo is very angry.
I beg your pardon?
I said that cuckoo is very angry. Listen.
How can you tell?
Timbre. Oh, no moon. Well, I guess it's just as well. There's mist rising from the marshes. There's no need for me to light my bicycle lamp, is there? I mean, no one is likely to fall over it.
No, we're not expecting anybody else.
Good night, you foolish bird. You have a table?
Yes, we thought that one would do.
I think the one that has the drinks on it would be better.
Very well.
This is a moment I always hate.
Are you nervous?
Yes. When I was a girl, I always used to be sick.
How fortunate that you grew out of it.
Children are always much more prone to be sick than grown-ups, though, aren't they? I know I could never travel on a train with any degree of safety until I was 14.
Little Tommy Tucker sings for his supper. What shall he have but brown bread and butter? I despise that because it doesn't rhyme at all, but Daphne loves it!
Now who's Daphne?
Daphne is Madame Arcati's control. She's a little girl.
Oh, I see.
How
yes,
old is
of
she?
Of course. How old is she?
She's rising 7 when she died.
And when was that?
February the 6th, 1884.
Oh, poor little thing.
She must have been a bit long in her tooth by now, I should think.
You should think, Dr. Bradman, but I fear that you don't. At least not profoundly enough.
Do be quiet, George. You'll throw Madame Arcati off.
Oh, don't worry, my dear. I'm quite used to skeptics. They usually turn out to be the most vulnerable and receptive in the long run.
You'd better take that warning to heart, Dr. Bradman.
Please forgive me, Madame Arcati. I can assure you I am most deeply interested.
It is of no consequence. Now, will you all please sit round the table and place your hands downward on it?
Mrs. Bradman?
What about the lights?
All in good time, Mr. Condamine. Sit down, please. I want the sun in the morning and the moon at night. I want the sun in the morning and the moon at night. Fingers should be touching. That's right. Now then, I presume that is the gramophone, Mr. Condamine.
Yes. Would you like me to start it? It's an electric one.
No, there you are. I can manage. Let's see, what have we here? Brahms. Oh, do me no. Rachmaninoff, too florid. Oh, where is the dance music?
They're the loose ones on the left.
I see.
I'm afraid they're none of them very new.
Oh, Daphne is really more attached to Irving Berlin than anyone else. She likes a tune she can hum. Oh, here's one. Always.
Always?
Do sit down, Charles. Whatever is the matter?
Nothing. Nothing at all.
The light switch is by the door.
Yes, all except for the small one on the desk and the gramophone.
Very well, I understand.
Keep still, Charles.
Now then, there are one or two things that I should like to explain. So will you all please listen attentively?
Of course.
Presently, when the music begins, I shall either walk around the room for a while or I may lie down flat. But in due course, I shall draw up this dear little stool and join you at the table. I shall place myself between you and your wife, Mr. Condamine, and rest my hands lightly on yours. I ask that you do not move, address me, or do anything the least bit distracting. Is that quite clear?
Perfectly.
Of course, I cannot guarantee that anything will happen at all. Daphne may be unavailable. She had a head cold very recently and was quite under the weather, poor child. But on the other hand, a great many things might occur. One of you may have an emanation, for instance. Or we may contact a poltergeist, which would be extremely destructive and noisy.
In what way destructive?
Oh, they throw things, you know.
No, I didn't know.
But we must cross that bridge when we come to it, mustn't we?
Yes, certainly, by all means.
Fortunately, an elemental at this time of year is most unlikely.
What do elementals do?
Oh, one can never tell, my dear. They are dreadfully unpredictable. Usually they take the form of a very cold wind.
Oh, I don't think I shall like that.
Sometimes reaching almost hurricane velocity.
Oh, you don't think it a good idea to take the more breakable ornaments off the mantelpiece before we start?
That won't be necessary, Mrs. Condamine. I assure you I have my own methods for dealing with elementals.
I'm so glad.
Now then, are you all ready to empty your minds?
Do you mean what you try to think of nothing?
Absolutely nothing, Dr. Bradman. Try to concentrate on a space or a nondescript color. That really is the best way.
I'll do my damnedest.
Good work. I shall now stop the music. No. Now then, is there anyone there? Is that you, Daphne? Is your cold better, dear? Oh, I'm so sorry. Are you doing anything for it? Oh, she seems rather fretful. Daphne, is there anyone there who wishes to speak to anyone here? Oh, now we're getting somewhere. Oh, Daphne, don't, dear. Oh, don't. You're hurting me, dear. Oh, please be a good child. Oh, that's a good dear. Now then, Daphne, you say there is someone there who wishes to speak to someone here. Is it me? Is it Dr. Bradman? Is it Mrs. Bradman? Is it Mrs. Condamine? Daphne, behave yourself. Is it Mr. Condamine? Someone wants to speak to you, Mr. Condamine.
Tell them to leave a message.
I really must ask you not to be flippant, Mr. Condamine.
Oh, Charles, how can you be so idiotic? You'll spoil everything.
Sorry, it slipped out.
Do you know anybody who has passed over recently?
Well, not recently, except perhaps my cousin in the civil service, but I can't imagine why he'd want to talk to me. We haven't spoken in years.
Are you Mr. Condamine's cousin in the civil service? Seems we've drawn a blank. Can you think of anyone else? Rack your brains.
It might be old Mrs. Plummer, you know. She died on Whit Monday.
I can't imagine why old Mrs. Plummett would want to communicate with me. We had very little in common.
It's worth trying, anyhow.
Are you old Mrs. Plummett?
She was very deaf. Perhaps you'd better shout.
Are you old Mrs. Plummett? there's nobody there at all.
Oh, how disappointing. Just when we were getting along so nicely.
Violet, be quiet.
Well, I'm afraid there's nothing for it but for me to go into a trance. I had hoped to avoid it because it is so exhausting, but what must be, must be. Please excuse me for a moment while I restart the gramophone.
Don't play always, not always.
Why ever not, Charles? Don't be absurd.
I'm afraid I must. It would be imprudent to switch horses midstream, if you know what I mean.
Very well, have it your own way.
They doubt me. She often had her own noise out.
George, please.
Oh, good God.
Oh, keep still.
I can't hold it.
Press down on.
Oh. There now. Aren't we to pick it up or just leave it there?
How the hell do I know?
Well, there's no need to snap at me.
Leave it where it is.
Who said that?
Who said what?
Someone said leave it where it is.
Nonsense, dear.
I heard it distinctly.
Well, nobody else did they? I never heard a sound.
It's you, Ruth. You're playing tricks.
I'm not doing anything of the sort. I haven't uttered.
Good evening, Charles.
Ventriloquism. That's what it is. Ventriloquism.
What is the matter with you?
But you must have heard that. One of you must have heard that.
Heard what?
You mean to sit there solemnly and tell me that you, none of you, heard anything at all?
I certainly didn't.
I never heard a sound. I wish I had. I would have loved to hear something.
It's you who are playing the tricks, Charles. You're acting to try to frighten us.
I'm not. I swear I'm not.
It's difficult to think of what to say after 7 years. But I suppose good evening's as good as anything else.
Who are you?
Elvira, of course. Don't be so silly.
I can't bear another minute of this. Get up, everybody. The entertainment's over.
Oh, Charles, how tiresome of you. Just when we were beginning to enjoy ourselves.
Never again, that's all I can say. Never, never again, as long as I live.
What on earth's the matter with you?
Nothing's the matter with me. I'm just sick of the whole business, that's all.
Did you hear anything that we didn't hear, really?
No, of course not. I was just pretending.
I know you were.
Oh, dear. Look at Madame Arcati.
Oh, what are we to do with her?
Bring her round. Bring her round as soon as possible.
Well, I think we'd better leave her alone.
But she might stay like that for hours.
She's out all right.
Now, bring her round. It's dangerous to leave her like that.
Charles, you are behaving most peculiarly.
Madame Arcati, wake up. It's time to go home.
Here, go easy, old man.
Get some brandy. Give her some brandy. Help me, Bradman. Madame Arcati... Little Tommy Tucker, Madame Arcati.
Here's the brandy.
Wake up.
Oh, she's coming round.
Be careful, Charles. You're spilling it all down her dress.
Well, that's that.
Are you all right?
Certainly, my dear. Never felt better in my life.
Would you like some more brandy?
So that's the funny taste in my mouth. Well, really. Fancy allowing them to give me brandy, Dr. Bradman. Why, you ought to have known better. Brandy on top of a trance? Why, it might have been catastrophic. Oh, please take it away. I probably shan't be able to sleep a wink tonight as it is.
I know I shan't.
Why ever not?
The whole experience has unhinged me.
Well, what happened? Was it satisfactory?
Nothing much happened after you went off, Madame Arcati.
I know that something happened. I can feel it. No poltergeist, at least. That's a good thing. Any apparitions?
Not a thing.
No ectoplasm?
I'm not quite sure what it is, but I don't think so.
Very curious. I feel as though something tremendous has taken place.
Charles pretended to hear a voice in order to frighten us.
It was only a joke.
And a very poor one, if I may say so. Nevertheless, I am prepared to swear that there is someone else that is psychic in this room apart from myself.
I don't see how there can be, really, Madame Arcati.
Oh, I do hope I haven't gone and released something. However, we shall find out within a day or two. If any manifestation should occur, or you hear any unexplained noises, you might let me know at once.
Of course we will. We'll telephone immediately.
Well, I really think I must be on my way now.
Wouldn't you like anything before you go?
Oh, no, thank you. I have some Ovaltine already in a saucepan at home. All it needs is hotting up.
Wouldn't you like to leave your bicycle here and let us drive you?
I really think you should, Madame Arcati. After that trance, you can't be feeling yourself. Oh, nonsense, my dear. I feel fit as a fiddle. Always feel capital after a trance. It rejuvenates me. Well, goodbye, Mrs. Condamine.
It was awfully sweet of you to take so much trouble.
I'm so sorry that so little occurred. It must be that cold of Daphne's, I expect. We must try again some other evening.
That would be lovely.
Goodbye, Mrs. Bradman.
It was thrilling. I felt the table shaking under my hands.
Goodbye, Doctor.
Congratulations, Madame Arcati.
I am fully aware of the irony in your voice, Dr. Bradman. As a matter of fact, you'd be an excellent subject for telepathic hypnosis. Oh, a good chum of mine is an expert. I should like her to look you over.
I'm sure I should be charmed.
Well, good night, everybody, and next time we must really put our backs into it. Goodbye.
Oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear.
Do be careful, Mrs. Condamine. She may hear you.
I can't help it. I've been holding this in for ages.
And she certainly puts you in your place. Serves you right.
She's raving mad, of course, mad as a hatter.
But do you think she believes?
Of course not. The whole thing was a put-up job. I must say, though, she shoots a more original line than they generally do.
I think she's probably half convinced herself by now.
Possibly. The trance was genuine enough, but that, of course, is easily accounted for.
Hysteria?
Yes, a form of hysteria, I should imagine.
I do hope Mr. Condamine got all the atmosphere he needed for his book.
He might have got a great deal more if he hadn't spoiled everything by showing off. I'm really very cross with him. Oh, I suddenly felt a draft. There must be a window open.
No, they're shut.
Perhaps it was one of those, what do you call it, that Madame Arcati was talking about.
Elementals.
No, it couldn't possibly be. She distinctly said it was the wrong time of year for elementals.
Well, the old girl's gone pedaling off down the drive at the hell of a speed. We had a little bit of trouble lighting her lamp.
Poor thing.
I have a theory about her, you know. I believe she's completely sincere.
Oh, Charles, how can she be?
Wouldn't it be possible, Doctor, some form of self-hypnotism or something?
It might be. As I was explaining to your wife just now, there are certain types of hysterical...
George, please. It's getting awfully late and we really must go home. You have to get up so early in the morning.
You see, the moment I begin talking about anything that really interests me, my wife interrupts me.
You know I'm right, George. It's after 11.
I'll do a little bit of reading up on the whole subject, just for the fun of it.
You must have a drink before you go.
No, thanks. Violet's quite right, I'm afraid. I have to get up abominably early tomorrow. I have a patient being operated on in Canterbury.
It was thrilling. I shall never forget it. It was sweet of you to include us.
Good night, Mrs. Condamine. Thank you so much.
You're sure about the drink?
Quite sure, thanks.
We'll be sure to let you know if we find any poltergeists whirling about.
I should never forgive you if you didn't.
Come along, darling.
Well, darling?
Well?
Would you say the evening had been profitable?
Yes, I suppose so.
I must say it was extremely funny at the moments.
Yes, it certainly was.
What's the matter?
Matter?
Yes, you seem odd somehow. Do you feel quite well?
Perfectly, yes. I think I'll have a drink. Do you want one?
No, thank you, dear.
It's a bit chilly in this room.
Come over by the fire.
I don't think I'll make any notes tonight. I'll start fresh in the morning. Oh, my God.
Charles?
That was very clumsy of you, Charles, darling.
Elvira, so then it was true. It is you.
Of course it is.
Charles, darling Charles, what are you talking about?
Are you a ghost?
I suppose I must be. It's all very confusing.
Charles, what do you keep looking over there for? Look at me. What's happened?
Don't you see?
See what?
Elvira.
Elvira?
Yes. Elvira, dear, this is Ruth. Ruth, this is Elvira.
Come and sit down, darling.
You mean to say you can't see her?
Listen, Charles, you just sit down quietly by the fire and I'll mix you another drink. Don't worry about the mess on the carpet. Edith can clean it up in the morning.
But you must be able to see her. Look, she's there, right in front of you, there.
Are you mad? What's happened to you?
You can't see her?
If this is a joke, Charles, it's gone quite far enough. Sit down, for God's sake, and don't be idiotic.
What am I to do? What the hell am I to do?
I think the very least you can do is be a little more pleased to see me after all you conjured me up.
I did no such thing.
Nonsense, of course you did. That awful child with the cold came and told me you wanted to see me urgently.
No, it was all a mistake, a horrid mistake.
Stop talking like that, Charles. As I told you before, the joke's gone far enough.
I've gone mad. That's what it is. I've gone raving mad.
Here, drink this.
This is appalling.
Relax.
How can I relax? I shall never be able to relax again as long as I live.
Drink some brandy.
There, now are you satisfied?
Now sit down.
Why are you so anxious for me to sit down? What good will that do?
I want you to relax. You can't relax standing up.
African natives can. They can stand on one leg for hours.
I don't happen to be an African native.
You don't happen to be a what?
An African native.
What's that got to do with it?
Never mind, Ruth. It doesn't matter. We'll say no more about it. See, I've sat down.
Would you like some more brandy?
Yes, please.
Very unwise. You always had a weak head.
I could drink you under the table.
There's no need to be aggressive, Charles. I'm doing my best to help you.
I'm sorry.
Here, drink this, and then we'll go up to bed.
Get rid of her, Charles, and then we can talk in peace.
That's a thoroughly immoral suggestion. You ought to be ashamed of yourself.
What is there immoral in that?
I wasn't talking to you.
Who were you talking to then?
Elvira, of course.
To hell with Elvira.
There now, she's getting cross.
I don't blame her.
What don't you blame her for?
Oh, God.
No. Now, look here, Charles. I've gathered you've some sort of plan behind all this. I'm not quite a fool. I suspected you when we were doing that idiotic seance.
Don't be so silly. What plan could I have?
I don't know. Something to do with the characters in your book. How they or one of them would react to a sudden situation. I refuse to be used as a guinea pig unless I'm warned beforehand what it's all about.
But Ruth, Elvira is here in this room. Look, she's just there, a few yards away from you.
Oh, yes, darling. I can see her distinctly. Under the piano with a zebra.
But Ruth...
I'm not going to stay here arguing any longer.
Hooray!
Shut up.
How dare you speak to me like that?
Ruth, please, listen.
I will not listen to any more of this nonsense. I'm going up to bed now, and I shall leave you to turn out the lights. I shan't be asleep. I'm too upset. So you may come in and say goodnight to me if you feel like
it. Oh, that's big of her, I must say.
Be quiet. You're behaving like a gutter snipe.
That is all I have to say. Good night, Charles.
Ruth.
That was one of the most enjoyable half hours I've ever spent.
Elvira, how could you?
Oh, poor Ruth.
This must be some sort of an hallucination, isn't it?
I don't know the technical term for it.
What am I to do?
What Ruth suggested. Relax.
Where have you come from?
You know, it's very peculiar, but I seem to have forgotten.
Are you to be here indefinitely?
I don't know that either.
Oh, God.
Why would you hate it so much if I was?
Well, you must admit it would be embarrassing.
I don't see why. It's just a question of adjusting yourself. Anyway, I think it's horrid of you to be so unwelcoming and disagreeable.
Now, see here, Elvira.
I do. I think you're mean.
But try to see my point. I've been married to Ruth for 5 years, and you've been... for 7 years, and you've been dead for 5. Or the other way around.
Not dead, Charles. Passed over. It's considered vulgar to say dead where I come from.
Passed over, then.
Well, at any rate, now that I'm here, I think the very least you can do is make a pretense of being amiable about it.
Of course, my dear, I'm delighted in one way.
Oh, I don't think you love me anymore.
I shall always love the memory of you.
Oh, you mustn't think me unreasonable, but I am a little hurt. You called me back, and at great inconvenience I came, and you've been thoroughly churlish ever since I arrived.
Believe me, Elvira, I most emphatically did not send for you. It's all a horrid mistake.
Well, someone did, and that child said it was you. I remember I was playing backgammon with a very sweet Oriental gentleman. I think his name was Genghis Khan. I had just rolled double sixes when the child paged me, and the next thing I knew, here I was in this room. Perhaps it was your subconscious.
But you must find out whether you're going to stay or not, and then we can make arrangements accordingly.
I don't see how I can.
But try to think. You must know someone you could get in touch with over on the other side who could contact, and they could give you some advice.
I can't think. It seems so far away. It's almost as if I dreamed it.
But you must know somebody there besides Genghis Khan.
No, Charles.
What is it?
I want to cry, but I don't think I'm able to.
What do you want to cry for?
Oh, it's you, being as irascible as you always used to be.
I don't mean to be irascible, Elvira.
No. Darling, I don't mind. I don't mind, really. I never did.
Is it cold being a ghost?
No, I don't think so.
What happens if I touch you?
I doubt that you can, but you want to.
Oh, Elvira.
Oh, what is it, dear?
I feel so strange seeing you again.
Oh, that's better.
What's better?
Your voice. It was kinder.
Was I ever unkind to you when you were alive?
Often.
Oh, how kind you. That must be an exaggeration.
Oh, not at all. You were an absolute pig the time we went to Cornwall and stayed in that awful hotel. You hit me with a billiard cue.
Oh, only very, very gently.
I loved you very much.
I loved you too. No, I can't touch you. Isn't it horrid?
Well, perhaps if I'm going to stay here for any length of time, it's just as well.
I suppose I shall wake up eventually, but I feel strangely peaceful right now.
That's right. Put your head back.
Like that?
Can you feel anything?
Only a very slight breeze through my hair.
Well, that's better than nothing.
I suppose if I'm really out of my mind, they'll take me away to an asylum.
Oh, don't worry, darling. Just relax.
Mm. Poor Ruth.
To hell with Ruth. Mm.
Good morning, darling.
Good morning, Charles.
It certainly is.
What certainly is what?
A good morning, a tremendously good morning. There isn't a cloud in the sky and everything looks newly washed.
It is keeping your breakfast hot. You'd better ring.
Anything interesting in the Times?
Don't be silly, Charles.
I think I'll work all day.
Good.
It's extraordinary about daylight, isn't it?
How do you mean?
Oh, it reduces everything to normal.
Does it?
Yes, it does.
I'm sure I'm very glad to hear it.
You're very glacial this morning.
Are you surprised?
Frankly, yes. I expected more of you.
Well, really?
I've always looked upon you as a woman of perception and understanding.
Perhaps this is one of my off days.
Good morning, Edith.
Good morning, sir.
Feeling fit?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
And how's cook?
I don't know, sir. I haven't asked her.
You should. You should begin every day by asking everyone how they are. It oils the wheels.
Yes, sir.
Greet her from me, will you?
Yes, sir.
That will be all for the moment, Edith.
Yes, Mom.
I wish you wouldn't be facetious with the servants, Charles. It confuses them and undermines their morale.
I consider that point of view retrogressive, if not downright feudal.
I don't care what you consider it. I have to run the house and you don't.
Are you implying that I couldn't?
You're at liberty to try.
I take back what I said about it being a good morning. It's a horrid morning.
You'd better eat your breakfast while it's hot.
It isn't.
Now look here, Charles. In your younger days, this display of roguish flippancy might have been alluring. In a middle-aged novelist, it's nauseating.
Do you want me to writhe at your feet in a frenzy of self-abasement?
That would be equally as nauseating, but certainly more appropriate.
I don't see what I've done that's so awful.
You behaved abominably last night. You wounded me and insulted me.
I was the victim of an aberration.
Nonsense! You were drunk.
Drunk?
You had 4 strong dry martinis before dinner, a great deal too much burgundy with dinner, heaven knows how much port and kummel with Dr. Bradman, while I was doing my best to entertain that mad woman. Then you had 2 double brandies later. I gave them to you myself. Of course you were drunk.
So that's your story, is it?
You refused to come to bed, and when I finally came down at 3 in the morning to see what had happened to you, I found you in an alcoholic coma on the sofa with the fire out and your hair all over your face.
I was not in the least drunk, Ruth. Something happened to me last night. Something very peculiar happened to me.
Nonsense.
It isn't nonsense. I know it looks like nonsense now in the clear, remorseless light of day, but last night it was anything but nonsense. I honestly had some sort of hallucination.
I'd really rather not discuss it any further.
But you must discuss it. It's very disturbing.
There, I agree with you. It showed you up in a most unpleasant light. I find that extremely disturbing.
Last night during the seance, I was convinced that I heard Elvira's voice.
Nobody else did.
I can't help that. I did.
You couldn't have.
And later on, I saw her. I saw her very distinctly here in this room. And I talked to her. And after you went up to bed, we had quite a cozy little chat.
And you seriously expect me to believe that you weren't drunk?
I wasn't. I couldn't have been all that drunk. I should have a dreadful hangover this morning if I were.
I'm not at all sure you haven't.
But I haven't the trace of a headache and my tongue's not coated. Look.
I've not the least desire to look at your tongue. Kindly put it in again.
I know what it is. You're frightened.
Frightened? Rubbish. What is there to be frightened
of? Elvira. It wouldn't have mattered to you all that much even if I had been drunk. It's because it's all mixed up with Elvira.
I seem to remember telling you before dinner last night that your views of female psychology were rather didactic. I was right. I should have added that they were puerile.
That's when it all began.
When what all began?
We were talking much too much about Elvira. It's dangerous to have someone strongly in your mind when you begin to dabble with the occult.
She certainly wasn't strongly in my mind.
Well, she was in mine.
Oh, she was she?
Well, you tried to make me say that she was more physically attractive than you, so that you could hold it over me.
I did not. I don't give a hoot how physically attractive she was.
Oh, yes, you do. Your whole being is devoured with jealousy.
Oh, this is too much.
Women. My God, what I think of women.
Just because you've always been dominated by them doesn't necessarily follow you know anything about them.
I've never been dominated by anyone.
You were hag-ridden by your mother until you were 23. Then you got into the clutches of that awful Mrs. Whatever her name
Mrs.
was.
Mrs. Winthrop Llewellyn.
I'm not interested. Then there was Elvira. She ruled you with a rod of iron.
Elvira never ruled anyone. She was much too elusive. That was one of her greatest charms.
Then there was Maud Charteris.
Oh, my affair with Maud Charteris lasted exactly 7.5 weeks, and she cried all the time.
Oh, the tyranny of tears! Then there was...
If you wish to make an inventory of my sex life, my dear, I feel it only fair to tell you that you've missed out several episodes. I shall consult my diary and give you a complete list after lunch.
It's no use trying to impress me with your routine amorous exploits.
The only woman in my life who's ever tried to dominate me is you. You've been at it for years.
That is completely untrue.
No, it isn't. You boss me and bully me and order me about. You won't even allow me to have an hallucination if I want to.
Charles, alcohol will ruin your whole life if you allow it to get hold on you, you know.
Once and for all, Ruth, what happened last night had nothing whatsoever to do with alcohol. You have very adroitly rationalized the whole affair to your own satisfaction, but your deductions are based on complete fallacy. I'm willing to grant you there was an aberration, an odd psychic delusion of some sort, brought on by perhaps suggestion or hypnosis, but I was stone cold sober from first to last, and extremely upset into the bargain.
You were upset indeed. What about me?
You behaved with a stolid, obtuse lack of comprehension that frankly shocked me.
I consider I was remarkably patient. I shall know better next time.
Instead of putting out a comradely hand to guide me, you shouted staccato orders at me like a sergeant major.
You seem to forget that you gratuitously insulted me.
I did not.
You called me a gutter snipe. You told me to shut up. And when I quietly suggested we should go up to bed, you said with the most disgusting leer that it was an immoral suggestion.
I wasn't talking to you. I was talking to Elvira.
Oh, well, if you were, I can only say that it conjures up a fragrant picture of your first marriage.
My first marriage was perfectly charming, and I find it in the worst possible taste for you to sneer at it.
I'm not nearly so interested in your first marriage as you think I am. It's your second marriage that's absorbing me at the moment. It seems to me to be on the rocks.
Only because you persist in taking up this ridiculous attitude.
My attitude is that of any normal woman whose husband gets drunk and hurls abuse at her.
I was not drunk.
Be quiet. They'll hear you in the kitchen.
I don't care if they hear me in the Folkestone Town Hall. I was not drunk.
Control yourself, Charles.
How can I control myself in the face of your idiotic damned stubbornness? It's giving me claustrophobia.
Oh, you'd better ring up Dr. Brad.
Can I clear, please, Mom?
Yes, Edith.
Cook wants to know about lunch, Mom.
Will you be into lunch, Charles?
Please don't worry about me. I shall be perfectly happy with a bottle of gin in my bedroom.
Don't be silly, dear. Tell Cook we should both be in.
Yes, Mum.
I'm going into Hythe this morning. Is there anything that you want?
Yes, a great deal, but I don't think you'll find it in Hythe.
Tell Cook to put Alka-Seltzer down on my list, will you, Edith?
Yes, Mum.
It's clouding over.
You have a genius for understatement.
Don't worry about the table, Edith. I'll put it away.
Yes, Mum.
Please, Ruth, be reasonable.
I'm perfectly reasonable.
I wasn't pretending. I really did believe that I saw Elvira, and when I heard her voice, I was appalled.
You put up with it for 5 years.
And when I saw her, I had the shock of my life. That's when I dropped the glass.
But you couldn't have seen her.
I know I couldn't have, but I did.
I'm willing to concede, then, that you imagined that you did.
That's what I've been trying to explain to you for hours.
Well, then there's obviously something wrong with you.
Exactly. There is something wrong with me. Something fundamentally wrong with me. And that's why I've been imploring your sympathy. And all I got was a sterile temperance lecture.
You had been drinking, Charles. There's no denying that.
No more than usual.
Well, how do you account for it, then?
I can't account for it. That's what's so awful.
Did you feel quite well yesterday? During the day, I mean.
Of course I did.
What did you have for lunch?
You ought to know. You had it with me.
Let me see. There was lemon sole and that cheese thing.
Why should having a cheese thing for lunch make me see my deceased wife after dinner?
You never know. It was rather rich.
Well, then why didn't you see your dead husband? You had as much of it as I did.
This is not getting us anywhere at all.
Of course not, and it won't, as long as you insist on ascribing supernatural phenomenon to colonic irritation.
Supernatural grandmother.
No, I'd admit she'd have been much less agitating.
Perhaps you ought to see a nerve specialist.
I'm not in the least neurotic and never have been.
A psychoanalyst, then.
I refuse to endure months of expensive humiliation, only to be told at the end of it that at the age of 4, I was in love with my rocking horse.
What do you suggest, then?
I don't suggest anything. I'm profoundly uneasy.
Perhaps there's something pressing on your brain.
If there should be something pressing on my brain, I should have violent headaches, shouldn't I?
Not necessarily. And uncle of mine had a lump the size of a cricket ball pressing on his brain for years, and he never felt a thing.
What happened to him?
He had it taken out, and he's been bright as a button ever since.
Well, I know that I should know if I had anything like that. But the thing is, why are we even talking about him? It's a sheer waste of valuable time.
I only brought him up as an example.
I've gone mad, that's what it is.
How do you feel now?
Physically, you mean?
Altogether.
Aside from being worried, I feel quite normal.
Good, and you're not hearing or seeing anything in the least unusual?
Not at all.
Ruined that board by the sun dial. It looks like a mixed salad.
Oh, my God.
Oh. What's the matter now?
She's here again.
What do you mean, who's here again?
Elvira.
Pull yourself together and don't be absurd.
It's all those nasturtiums. They look so vulgar.
I like nasturtiums.
You like what?
So they're all right in moderation, but in a mass like that, they look beastly.
Ruth, help me. You've got to help me.
What did you mean about nasturtiums?
Never mind that. I tell you, she's here again.
You've been having a nice scene, haven't you? I heard you all the way down the garden.
Oh, please mind your own business.
If you're behaving like a lunatic isn't my business, nothing is.
I know I should feel sorry, but I'm not. I'm delighted.
How can you be so inconsiderate?
Inconsiderate? I like that, I must say.
Ruth, darling, please.
I've done everything I can to help. I've controlled myself admirably. And I should like to say here and now that I don't believe a word about your damned hallucination. You're up to something, Charles. There's been a certain furtiveness in your manner for weeks. Why don't you be honest and tell me what it is?
No, Ruth, you're wrong. You're dead wrong.
You're trying to upset me. You're trying to goad me into doing something I might regret. I won't stand for it anymore. You're making me utterly miserable.
Ruth, darling.
Don't come near me.
Oh, let her have a nice cry. It'll do her good.
You're utterly heartless.
Heartless?
Ruth, I wasn't talking to you. I was talking to Elvira.
Go on talking to her then. Talk to her till you're blue in the face, but don't talk to me.
Elvira, help me.
How?
Make her see you or something.
Oh, I'm afraid I couldn't manage that. It's the most complicated business. Frightfully complicated, you know. It takes years of study.
Well, you're here, aren't you? You aren't an illusion.
Oh, I'm most definitely here. Might be an illusion, but I'm here.
How did you get here?
I told you last night I don't exactly know.
Well, you must make me a promise that in the future when you come, you'll only come to talk to me when I'm alone.
Oh, how unkind of you to be so unwelcoming. I've never been treated so rudely.
Elvira, I don't mean to be rude.
It's your own fault for having married a woman who's she cannot even see beyond the nose on her face. If she had a grain of sympathy or affection for you, she'd believe what you tell her.
How could you expect anyone to believe this?
Oh, you'd be surprised how gullible people are. We often laugh about it on the other side.
Charles?
Yes, dear?
I understand. I'm awfully sorry I was cross.
But, my dear...
I understand everything now. I do, really.
You do?
Yes, of course I do.
Look out. She's up to something.
Will you please be quiet?
Of course, darling. We'll all be quiet, won't we? We'll be quiet as little mice.
Ruth, darling, listen.
I want you to come upstairs with me and go to bed.
Oh, the way that woman harps on bed is nothing short of erotic.
I'll deal with you later.
Very well, dear. Come along.
What are you up to?
I'm not up to anything, darling. I just want you to come to bed and wait there until Dr. Bradman comes.
No, Ruth, you're wrong.
Come, dear.
She'll have you in a straitjacket before you know where you are.
Elvira, you've got to help me.
I would if I could. I don't know how I can.
I can. Ruth.
Yes, dear.
If I promise to go up to bed, will you bear with me for just 5 minutes longer?
No, I think it would be better.
But bear with me. No matter how mad it may seem, just for 5 minutes longer.
Very well. What is it?
Sit down.
All right. There.
Now, listen carefully.
Have a cigarette. It'll calm your nerves.
Don't want a cigarette.
Then you shan't have one, darling.
Ruth, I want to explain to you clearly and without emotion that beyond any question of a doubt, the ghost or shade or whatever you want to call it of my first wife, Elvira, is here in this room now.
Yes, dear.
I know you don't believe it, and you're trying valiantly to humor me, but I intend to prove it to you.
Why not lie down and have a nice rest, and you can prove anything you want to later on?
She may not be here later on.
Oh, don't worry, she will.
Oh, God.
Hush, dear.
Promise me you'll do what I ask.
It depends on what it is.
Ruth, you see that bowl of flowers on the piano?
Yes, dear, I did it myself this morning.
Very untidily, if I may say so.
You may not.
Very well, I never will again, I promise.
Ruth, Elvira will now carry that bowl of flowers from the piano to the mantelpiece and back again. You will, Elvira, just to please me, won't you?
I don't see why I should. You've been insufferable to me ever since I materialized.
Please.
Oh, very well, just this once. Not that I approve of these Houdini carryings on.
Now, Ruth, watch carefully.
Very well, dear.
Elvira, go ahead. Bring the bowl of flowers to the mantelpiece and back.
Ooh. Charles, how can you? You ought to be ashamed of yourself.
Whatever for?
It's a trick. I know perfectly well it's a trick. You've been working up to this. It's all part of some horrible plan.
No, it's not a trick. I swear it's not. Elvira, do something else, for heaven's sake.
And
you want to get rid of me. You're trying to drive me out of my mind. No. You're cruel and sadistic, and I'll never forgive you. No. I'm not going to put up with this anymore.
Ruth, it's not a trick, I swear.
Let me go immediately.
It was Elvira, I swear. It was Elvira.
Let me go. This is madness, Charles. Sheer madness. It's some sort of auto-suggestion, isn't it? Some form of hypnotism. Swear to me it's only that. Swear to me it's only that.
Hypnotism, my foot.
Madame Marcotti.
My dear Mrs. Condamine, I came directly as I got your message.
That was very kind of you.
Oh, kind nonsense. Nothing kind about it. I look upon it as an outing.
I'm so glad. Will you have some tea?
China or Indian?
China.
Oh, good. I never touch Indian. It upsets my vibrations.
Do sit down.
Thank you. I find this room very interesting. Very interesting. I noticed it the other night.
I'm not at all surprised.
Have you ever been to Cowden Manor?
No, I'm afraid I haven't.
Oh, that's very interesting, too. Strikes you like a blow between the eyes the moment before when you walk into the drawing room. Two lumps of sugar, please, and no milk at all.
I'm profoundly disturbed, Madame Arcati, and I want your help.
Aha. I thought as much. What's in those sandwiches?
Cucumber.
Oh, couldn't be better. Fire away.
It's most awfully difficult to explain.
Facts first, explanations afterwards.
It's the facts that are difficult to explain. They're so fantastic.
Facts very often are. Take creative talent, for instance. How do you account for that? Look at Shakespeare or Michelangelo. Try to explain Mozart snatching sounds out of the air and putting them down on paper when he was practically a baby. That's plain facts. Oh, I know it's fashionable these days to ascribe it all to glands, but my reply to that is fiddly-dee.
Yes, I'm sure you're quite right.
There are more things in heaven and earth than are ever dreamt of in your philosophy, Mrs. Condamine.
Oh, there certainly are.
Come now, take the plunge. Out with it. You're hearing strange noises in the night, no doubt. Doors slamming, boards creaking, moaning in the passages. Is that it?
No, I'm afraid it isn't.
No sudden gusts of cold wind, I hope.
No, it's worse than that.
I'm all attention.
I know it sounds idiotic, but the other night during the seance, something happened.
I thought as much. Probably a poltergeist. Oh, they're enormously cunning. They sometimes lie doggo for days.
You know that my husband was married before.
Yes, I've heard it mentioned.
His first wife, Elvira, died comparatively young.
Where?
Here, in this house, in this very room.
Ooh, I'm beginning to see daylight.
She was convalescing after pneumonia and one evening started to laugh helplessly at a BBC musical program and died of a heart attack.
And she materialized the other evening after I had gone?
Not to me, but to my husband.
Oh, stop!
professional standpoint that it might be regarded as a major achievement.
A triumph, my dear! Nothing more nor less than a triumph!
But from my own personal point of view, it is, to say the least of it, embarrassing.
At last, a genuine materialization!
Please sit down again, Madame Arcati.
Oh, can anyone sit down at a moment like this? Why, it's tremendous! I haven't had such success since the Sudbury case.
Nevertheless, I must insist upon you sitting down again and controlling your natural exuberance. I fully appreciate your pride in your achievement, but I would like to point out that it has made my position in this house untenable and that I hold you entirely responsible.
Oh, please forgive me, Mrs. Condamine. I'm afraid I'm being abominably selfish. How may I help you?
How? By sending her back immediately to where she came from, of course.
I'm afraid that's easier said than done.
Do you mean to tell me she is liable to stay here indefinitely?
Oh, it's difficult to say. I fear it depends largely on her.
But my dear Madame Arcati...
Oh, where is she now?
My husband has driven her into Folkestone. Apparently she was anxious to see an old friend of hers who is staying at the Grand.
Please forgive this formality, but I must file a report with the psychical research people.
I would be very much obliged if no names were mentioned.
The report will be confidential.
This is a small village, you know, and gossip would be most undesirable.
I completely understand. Now then, you say she is visible only to your husband?
Yes.
Visible only to husband. Audible too, I presume?
Extremely audible.
Extremely audible. Your husband was devoted to her?
I believe so.
Husband devoted?
It was apparently a reasonably happy marriage.
Oh, tut, tut.
I beg your pardon.
When did she pass over?
7 years ago.
Aha. Uh-huh. That means she must have been on the waiting list.
Waiting list?
Yes, otherwise she would have gotten beyond the materialization stage by now. She must have put herself down for a return visit and wouldn't have been able to accomplish it unless there was a strong force at work.
Do you mean that Charles, my husband, wanted her back all that much?
Possibly. Or it might have been her own determination.
That sounds much more likely.
Would you say she's a woman of strong character?
I don't know, Madame Arcati. I never met her. Nor am I particularly concerned with how or why she got here. I am solely concerned with how to get her away again as soon as possible.
I fully sympathize with you, Mrs. Condamine, and I assure you I shall do everything in my power to help, but at the moment I'm afraid I cannot offer any great hopes.
But I always understood there was a way of exorcising ghosts, some sort of ritual.
You mean the old bell and book method?
I suppose I do.
Poppycock, Mrs. Condamine. Oh, it was quite effective in the days of genuine religious belief, but all that has changed now. I believe the reduction in faith in the spirit world is causing grave concern.
Has it indeed?
There was a time when a drop of holy water could send even a poltergeist scampering for cover, but not anymore. Oh, soul in test and tongue.
Be that as it may, Madame Arcati, I must beg of you to do your utmost to dematerialize my husband's first wife as soon as possible.
The time has come for me to be frank with you, Mrs. Condamine, and let you know that I haven't the faintest idea how to set about it.
Do you mean to sit there and tell me that after having mischievously conjured up this ghost, or spirit, or whatever she is, and placed me in this hideous position, that you are unable to do anything about it at all?
Honesty is the best policy.
But it's outrageous. I ought to hand you over to the police.
You go too far, Mrs. Condamine.
I go too far indeed. Do you realize what your insane amateur muddling has done?
I have been a professional since I was a child, Mrs. Condamine. Amateur's a word I cannot tolerate.
It seems to me to be the height of amateurishness to evoke malignant spirits and not be able to get rid of them again.
I was in a trance. Anything can happen when I'm in a trance.
Well, I can only suggest then that you go into another one immediately and get this damned woman out of my house.
I can't go into a trance at a moment's notice. It takes hours of preparation. In addition to which, I must be extremely careful of my diet for days beforehand. Today, for instance, I had lunch with friends and I had pigeon pie. And what with this cucumber sandwich? It would make a trance out of the question.
Well, you've got to do something.
I shall file a report with the Society of Psychical Research at the earliest possible moment.
Will they be able to do anything?
I doubt it. Oh, they'll send an investigating committee and they'll do a lot of questioning and wall tapping and mumbo jumbo. And then they'll have a conference and you probably have to go to London to testify.
Oh, it's too humiliating. It really is.
Try not to upset yourself. Nothing can be achieved by upsetting yourself.
It's all very fine for you to talk like that, Madame Arcati. You don't seem to have the faintest realization of my position.
Try to look on the bright side.
Bright side indeed. Do you... If your husband's first wife suddenly appeared from the grave and came to live in the house with you, do you think you could look on the bright side?
I resent your tone, Mrs. Condamine. I really do.
You most decidedly have no right to. You are entirely to blame for this whole horrible situation.
Kindly remember that I came here the other evening on your own invitation.
On my husband's invitation.
Nevertheless, I did what I was requested to do, which was to give a seance and establish contact with the other side. I had no idea there was an ulterior motive mixed up with it.
Ulterior motive?
No, your husband was obviously eager to get in touch with his former wife. Had I been aware of it at the time, I naturally would have confided you first. After all, noblesse oblige.
He had no intention of trying to get in touch with anyone. The whole thing was planned in order for him to get material for a mystery story he is writing about a homicidal medium.
Am I to understand that I was only invited here in a spirit of mockery?
Not at all. He only wanted to make notes of some of the tricks of the trade.
Tricks of the trade? Insufferable. I have never been so insulted in all my life. I believe we have nothing more to say to one another, Mrs. Condamine. Goodbye.
Please don't go. Please don't go. Please.
Your attitude from the outset has been most unpleasant. Why, some of your remarks have been discourteous in the extreme. And I should like to say, without umbrage, that if you and your husband were foolish enough to tamper with the unseen for paltry motives and in a spirit of ribaldry, then whatever happens to you is your own fault. And, to coin a phrase, as far as I'm concerned, you can stow in your own juice, huh?
Damn! Damn! Damn!
What on earth was Madame Arcati doing here?
She came to tea.
Did you ask her?
Of course I did.
You didn't tell me you were going to.
You never told me you were going to ask Elvira to live with us.
I didn't.
Of course you did. It was your subconscious.
What on earth was the old girl so cross about? She practically cut me dead.
I told her the truth about why we invited her the other night.
That was quite unnecessary and most unkind.
She needed taking down a bit. She was blowing herself out like a pouter pigeon.
Why did you ask her to tea?
To get me exercised, of course. Oh, I do wish I could have a cucumber sandwich. I did love them so.
Is that true, Ruth?
It's what true?
What Elvira said.
You know perfectly well I can't hear what Elvira says.
She said you got Madame Arcati here to try to have her exorcised. Is that true?
We discussed the possibility.
There's a snake in the grass for you.
You had no right to do such a thing without consulting me.
I had every right. This situation is absolutely impossible, and you know it.
Ruth, if only you'd try and put out a little effort to try to be a little friendly with Elvira, we might all have quite a jolly time.
I have no wish to have a jolly time with Elvira.
She certainly is bad-tempered. You know, I can't think why you married her.
She's naturally a bit upset. We must make allowances.
I was never bad-tempered, though, was I? Even when you were beastly to me.
I was never beastly to you.
Where is Elvira at the moment?
In the chair here.
Now, look here, Elvira. I shall have to call you Elvira, shan't I? I can't very well go on calling you Mrs. Condamine all the time, can I? It would sound too silly.
I can't think why.
Did she say anything?
She said she'd like nothing better.
Oh, you are so sweet, Charles. I worship you.
I wish to be absolutely honest with you, Elmira.
Hold on to your hats, boys.
I admit I did ask Madame Arcanti here with the view of getting you exercise, and I believe that if you were in my position, you would have done exactly the same thing, wouldn't you?
I wouldn't have done it so obviously.
What did she say?
Nothing. She just smiled and nodded.
Thank you, Elvira. That's generous of you. I would really rather there be no misunderstandings between us.
That's very sensible, Ruth. I quite agree.
And so I would like to ask you a frank question. Why did you really come here? I can't see that you could have hoped to achieve anything by it beyond the immediate joke of making Charles into a sort of astral bigamist.
I came because the power of Charles' love tugged and tugged and tugged me, did it, my sweet?
What did she say?
She said she came because she wanted to see me again.
Well, she's done that now, hasn't she?
But we can't be inhospitable, Ruth.
I have no wish to be inhospitable. I would only like to have just an idea of how long you intend to stay, Elvira.
I don't know. I really don't know. Isn't that awful?
She said she doesn't know.
Well, surely that's a little inconsiderate.
Well, didn't the old spiritualist have any ideas on how to get rid of me?
What did Madame McCarthy say?
She said she couldn't do a thing.
Hooray!
Now, don't be upset, Ruth. We shall soon adjust ourselves. You must admit this is quite a unique experience. I see no valid reason why we shouldn't get a great deal of fun out of it.
Fun? Charles, how can you? You must be out of your mind.
No, not at all. Actually, I thought I was at first, but now I'm beginning to enjoy myself.
Oh, Charles, Charles.
Oh, she's off again.
Really, Elvira, you must not be so callous. It must be fair.
I suppose she said something insulting.
No, she didn't do anything of the sort.
Now, look here, Elvira.
She's over by the window now.
Why the hell can't she stay in the same place?
Temper again? What a terrible life you must lead, child dear.
Please shut up, darling. You only make everything worse.
Who was that darling addressed to, her or me?
Both of you.
This is intolerable.
Ruth, you're not going to go into another state again now, are you?
I've been doing my level best to control myself ever since yesterday morning, and I'd be damned if I'm going to do it anymore. The strain is too much. She has the advantage of being able to say whatever she pleases without me being able to hear her. But she can hear me all right, can't she? Without any modified interpreting.
Modified interpreting? I don't know what you mean.
Oh, yes, you do. You haven't told me once what she really said. You wouldn't dare. Judging from her photograph, she's the type who would use the most unpleasant language.
Well, you're not to talk like that, Ruth.
I've been making polite conversation all through dinner last night and breakfast and lunch today, and it's been a nightmare, and I'm not going to do it anymore. I don't like Elvira any more than she likes me, and what's more, I don't think I ever could have, dead or alive. If, since her untimely arrival here the other night, she had shown the slightest sign of good manners, the slightest sign of breeding, I might have felt differently towards her. But all she has done is have private jokes with you against me. I'm going up to my room now, and I shall have my dinner on a tray. The first thing in the morning, I am going up to London to interview the Psychical Research Society. And if they fail me, I shall go straight to the Archbishop of Canterbury!
Ruth, please.
Oh, let her go. She'll calm down later on.
It's unlike her to behave like that. She's generally so equable.
No, she isn't. Not really. Her mouth gives her away. It's a hard mouth, Charles.
Her mouth has nothing to do with it, and I resent you discussing Ruth as if she were a horse.
Do you love her?
Of course I do.
As much as you loved me?
Oh, don't be silly. It's all entirely different.
I'm so glad. Nothing could have ever been quite the same, could it?
You always behave very badly, Elvira.
Oh, Charles.
I'm grieved to see that your sojourn in the other world hasn't improved you in the least.
Go on. I love it when you pretend to be coarse with me.
I'm now going up to talk to Ruth.
Come. Cowardy custard.
Don't be idiotic. I can't let her go like that. I must be kind and sympathetic to her.
I don't see why. If she's intent on being disagreeable, I should just let her get on with it.
But the whole thing is very difficult for her.
Then she should learn to be more adaptable.
She probably will adapt in time, but it's been a shock.
Has it been a shock for you, too?
Of course it has. What do you expect?
A nice shock.
What do you want, Elvira?
Want? I don't know what you mean.
I remember whenever you were overpoweringly demure, it was because you wanted something.
Oh, how horrid of you to be so suspicious. All I want is to be with you.
Well, you are.
I mean alone with you. If you go upstairs and pamper Ruth and smarm her over, she'll probably come flouncing down, and our quiet, lovely evening together will be spoiled.
You're incorrigibly selfish, Elvira.
Well, I haven't seen you for 7 years. It's only natural that I'd want to be alone with you. Talk over old times. Oh, I'll let you go upstairs just for a little while if you really feel it's your duty.
Of course it is.
Then I don't mind.
You're disgraceful, Elvira.
You won't be gone long, will you? You'll come back very soon.
I shall probably dress for dinner while I'm upstairs.
You needn't.
You can read the Tatler or something.
You needn't dress for me.
I always dress for dinner.
What are you going to have? I should like to see you eat something really delicious.
Just be a good girl now. If you like, you could play the gramophone or something.
Thank you, Charles.
Certainly has.
You know, it happens that way sometimes. Everything seems to go wrong at once, exactly as though there were some evil spirits at work. I remember once George and I went away on a fortnight holiday shortly after we were married. The weather was vile. George sprained his ankle. I caught a cold and had to stay in bed for 2 days. And to crown everything, the lamp fell over in the sitting room and set fire to George's treatise he had written on hyperplasia of the abdominal glands.
How dreadful!
He had to write the whole thing over again, every single word.
You're sure you wouldn't like a cocktail or some sherry or anything?
No, thank you, really. George should be down in a moment, and we've got to go like lightning. We were supposed to be at the Wilmots at 7, and it's nearly that now.
I think I shall have a little sherry. I feel I need it.
Don't worry about your husband's arm, Mrs. Condamine. I'm sure it's only a sprain.
It's not his arm I'm worried about.
And I'm sure Edith will be up and around again in a few days.
My cook gave notice this morning.
Well, really, servants are awful, aren't they? Not a shred of gratitude. The first sign of trouble and they run out on you like rats leaving a sinking ship.
I can't feel that your simile is entirely fortunate, Mrs. Bradman.
Of course, I didn't mean it that way.
Nothing to worry about, Mrs. Condamine. It's only a slight sprain.
Oh, I'm so relieved.
He made a good deal of fuss about it when I examined. Mm-hmm. Men are much worse patients than women, you know. Particularly highly strung men like your husband.
Is he highly strung, do you think?
Yes, as a matter of fact, I wanted to talk to you about that. I'm afraid he's been overworking lately.
Overworking?
He's in rather a nervous condition. Nothing serious, you understand. But I do suggest a complete rest for a couple of weeks.
You mean he ought to go away?
I do. In a case like this, a change of atmosphere can work wonders.
I see. What symptoms did you notice?
Well, nothing to be unduly alarmed about. A certain air of strain. An inability to focus his eyes on the person he's talking to. A few rather remarked irrelevancies in his conversation.
I see. Can you remember any specific example?
No, he suddenly shouted, "What are you doing in the bathroom?" And a little later, while I was writing him a prescription, he said, "For God's sake, behave yourself."
Extraordinary.
He often goes on like that, particularly when he's immersed in writing a book.
No, I'm not in the least perturbed about it, really, but I do think a rest and a change would be a good idea.
Thank you so much, Doctor. Would you like some sherry?
No, thank you. We really must be off.
How is poor Edith?
She'll be all right in a few days. She's still recovering from the concussion.
It's funny, isn't it, that your housemaid and your husband should fall down on the same day?
Yes, if that sort of thing amuses you.
Oh, well, I didn't mean it that way, really.
Come along, my dear. You're talking too much, as usual.
Oh, you are horrid, George. Goodbye, Mrs. Gondamine.
Goodbye.
Well, how does it feel?
It's all right.
It's only a slight sprain, you know.
Is this downswing really essential?
It's a wise precaution. It will prevent you from using your left hand, except when it's really necessary.
I planned on going into Folkestone this evening.
It would be much better if you didn't.
It's most inconvenient.
You can easily wait and go tomorrow, Charles.
Oh, I can't stand another dreary night in this house. I'll go dotty, and I haven't seen a movie in 7 years.
Let me be the first to congratulate you.
What's that, old man?
Charles, try to be sensible, I implore you.
Sorry, I forgot.
Well, you can drive the car if you promise to go very slowly and carefully. Your gear change is on the right, isn't it?
Yes.
Well, use your left hand as little as possible.
All right.
You'd much better stay at home.
Well, couldn't you drive him in?
I'm afraid not. I've lots to do around the house, and there's Edith to be attended to.
Well, I'll leave you to fight it out among yourselves. But remember, if you do insist on going, carefully does it. The roads are very slippery anyhow. Come along, Violet.
Goodbye again. Goodbye, Mr. Gondamine.
You really are infuriating, Elvira. Surely you could wait and go to the movies another night. And stop behaving like a schoolgirl. You're old enough to know better.
What?
I was talking to Elvira.
She isn't here.
She was a moment ago. She threw a rose at me.
She's been very high-spirited all day. I know this mood of old. It usually meant she was up to something.
You're sure she isn't here? I'm
quite sure.
I want to talk to you.
Oh, God.
I must. It's important.
But Ruth, you've been very well behaved the last few days. You're not going to start making scenes again, I hope.
I resent that air of patronage, Charles. I have behaved well, as you call it, because there was nothing else to do. But I feel it only fair to warn you that I offer no guarantee for the future. My patience is being stretched to its uttermost.
As far as I can see, the situation is just as difficult for Elvira as it is for you, if not more so. The poor little thing comes back trustingly after all those years in the other world. And what is she faced with? Nothing but brawling and hostility.
What did she expect?
Surely even an ectoplasmic manifestation has the right to expect a little of the milk of human kindness.
Milk of human fiddlesticks!
Well, that doesn't even make sense, Ruth.
Elvira's about as trusting as a puff adder.
You're granite, Ruth. Sheer, unyielding granite.
And she's a great deal more dangerous into the bargain.
Dangerous? I never heard of anything so ridiculous. How can a poor, wistful, lonely little spirit like Elvira be dangerous?
Quite easily, and she is. She's beginning to show her hand.
Oh, in what way?
This is a fight, Charles, a bloody battle, a duel to the death between Elvira and me. Don't you realize that?
Melodramatic hysteria.
It isn't melodramatic hysteria. It's true. Can't you see?
No, you're imagining things. Jealousy causes people to have the most curious delusions.
I am making every effort not to lose my temper with you, Charles, but I must say you are making it increasingly difficult for me.
All this talk of battles and duels?
She came here with one purpose and one purpose only, and if you can't see that, you're a bigger fool than I thought you.
No, I can't see that.
Her purpose is perfectly obvious. It is to get you to herself forever.
That's absurd. How could she?
By killing you off, of course.
Killing me off? You're mad.
Why do you suppose Edith fell down the stairs and nearly cracked her skull?
What's Edith got to do with it?
Because the hole at the top of the stair was covered in axle grease. Cook discovered it afterwards.
Oh, you're making this up, Ruth.
I'm not. I swear I'm not. Why do you suppose when you were lopping that dead branch off the pear tree that the ladder broke? Because it had been practically sawn through on both sides.
But why would she want to kill me? I can understand her wanting to kill you, but why me?
If you were dead, it would be her final triumph over me. She'd have you with her forever on her damned astral plane, and I to be left high and dry. Oh, she's probably planning a sort of spiritual remarriage. I wouldn't put anything past her.
Ruth.
Don't you see now?
No, I don't. She couldn't be so sly, so wicked.
Couldn't she just?
No, as a character, she was always light and irresponsible, but I would never believe her capable of low cunning.
Perhaps the spirit world has deteriorated
her. Oh, Ruth.
Oh, for heaven's sake, stop looking like a wounded spaniel and concentrate. This is serious.
Well, what are we to do?
Behave perfectly ordinarily as though nothing had happened, and don't let her suspect a thing. I'm going to see Madame Arcati immediately. I don't care how cross she is. She's got to help us. Even if she can't get rid of Elvira, surely she knows some technical method of rendering her harmless. If a trance is necessary, she shall go into a trance if I have to beat her into it. I'll be back in half an hour. Tell Elvira I've got to see the vicar.
This is appalling.
Never mind about that. Remember, don't give yourself away by so much as a flick of an eyelid.
Look out.
What?
I merely said it's a nice lookout.
Oh,
the weather, Elvira. It's positively, the glass is dropping and dropping and dropping. It's positively macabre.
I find it difficult to believe at this particular moment you and Ruth have nothing more interesting to discuss than the weather.
I can't stand this anymore. I really can't.
Now then, Ruth.
What did she say?
Broken out again.
She asked if you'd broken out again.
How dare you talk like that, Elvira? Charles and I were not talking about the weather as you so shrewdly suspected. I should loathe you to think that we... I should loathe you to think that we had any secrets from you, and so I will tell you exactly what we were talking about. I was trying... What? I was trying to persuade him not to drive you into Folkestone this evening. It would be bad for his arm, and you can perfectly easily wait and go tomorrow. However, as he seems determined to put your wishes before mine and everything, I'm sure I have nothing further to say. I hope you both enjoy yourselves.
Ruth. Now then.
Oh, have you been beastly to her?
No, Ruth doesn't like being thwarted any more than you do.
Oh, she's a woman of sterling character. It's a pity she's so ungiving.
As I told you before, I'd rather not discuss Ruth with you. It makes me uncomfortable.
Very well. I won't mention her again. Are you ready?
What for?
To go to Folkestone, of course.
No, I want to have a glass of sherry first.
I don't believe you want to take me at all.
Of course I want to take you. But it really would be more sensible to wait until tomorrow. It's a filthy night.
Oh, how familiar this is.
In what way familiar?
All through our married life, I only had to make a suggestion and you immediately started hedging me off.
I'm not hedging you off. I merely said...
Fine, fine. We'll spend another cozy evening at home with Ruth sewing on that hideous table center and snapping at us like a terrier.
Ruth is perfectly aware that the table center is hideous. It happens to be a birthday present for her mother.
Oh, you needn't defend her tastes to me. They're thoroughly artsy craftsy, and
you
know it.
They're not artsy craftsy.
She's absolutely ruined this room. Look at the curtains and that awful show on the piano.
Lady McKinley sent it to us from Burma.
Obviously because someone sent it to her from Birmingham.
If you don't behave yourself, I shan't take you to Folkestone ever.
Oh, Charles, don't be elderly and grand with me. Please, let's go now.
Not until I finish my sherry.
Oh, how tiresome you are. I've been waiting around for hours.
And then another few minutes shouldn't make any difference.
Oh, very well.
Besides, the car won't be back for half an hour at least.
What do you mean?
Ruth's taking it to go and see the vicar.
What?
What on earth's the matter?
You say Ruth's taking the car?
Yes, to go and see the vicar, but she won't be long.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
Elvira?
Stop her. You've got to go stop her at once.
Whatever for?
Go stop her! Stop her immediately!
It's too late. I heard her leave a few minutes ago.
Oh!
Elvira!
Oh!
What are you going on? What are you going on like this for? What have you done?
I've done anything. I don't know what you mean.
What are you in such a state for?
I'm not in a state. I don't know what you're talking about.
You've done something dreadful.
No, Charles. No, I promise. I haven't. I swear. I haven't.
You're lying to me, Elvira.
I'm not lying. What's there to lie about?
You have. Oh. You've done something awful.
Oh, dear, Charles. Oh.
Oh, my God. The car.
No. No, Charles, no.
Ruth was right. You did want to kill me. You've done something to the car.
No!
What have you done? Answer me! Answer me! What have you done?
I haven't done anything. I promise. I swear. Oh, dear. Oh, God.
Hello? Hello? Yes, speaking? Huh. Oh, I see. The bridge at the bottom of the hill? Thank you. Yes. No, I'll come at once.
Of all the low-down, dirty tricks. Ow! Ruth, ow! Ow, let me go! Ow!
Madame Arcadi.
I do hope you won't consider this an intrusion, Mr. Condon.
Not at all. Please sit down.
Oh, thank you.
Would you like some coffee or liqueur?
No, thank you. I had to come, Mr. Condamine.
Yes?
I felt a tremendous urge, like a rushing wind. So I hopped on my bike and here I am.
That was most kind of you.
Oh, no, no, no. Not kind at all. It was my duty. I know it strongly.
Duty?
I reproach myself bitterly, you know.
Oh, please don't. There's no necessity for that.
I allowed myself to get into a huff the other day with your late wife. I rode all the way home in the grip of temper, and I've regretted it ever since.
My dear Madame Arcadi.
Oh, please allow me to go on. Mine is the shame. Mine is the blame. Had I not been so impetuous, I shall never be able to forgive myself. Had I listened to the cool voice of reason, oh, so much might have been averted.
But you told my wife distinctly that you were unable to help her. You were perfectly honest with her. Other than the original unfortunate mistake, I see no reason for you to reproach yourself.
But I threw up the sponge. In a moment of crisis, I threw up the sponge instead of throwing down the gauntlet.
Whatever you threw, Madame Arcadi, I very much fear that nothing else could have been done. Circumstances were a bit strong for all of us.
I cannot bring myself to admit defeat so easily. It is gall and wormwood to me. I could at least have concentrated, made an effort.
Never mind.
Oh, but I do mind. I can't help it. I mind with every fiber of my being. I've been thinking very carefully. I've also been reading up a good deal these last few dreadful days. I gather we're alone?
Yes. My first wife is lying down. She's not here, of course. She is exhausted by the funeral. But my second wife is with her, as far as I know. But, of course, I have no way of knowing for certain.
You remarked no difference in the texture of your first wife since the accident.
No, every bit as usual, perhaps a trifle under the weather, a bit low-spirited, but that's all.
Well, that washes that out.
I don't understand.
Oh, just a little theory I had. In the 19th century, it was a pretty widespread belief that any ghost who had participated in the death of a human being disintegrated automatically.
Madame Arcadi, how did you know that Elvira was in any way responsible for Ruth's death?
What a pretty name. It has a definite look to it, hasn't it? Elvira.
You haven't answered my question. How did you know?
It came to me last night, Mr. Condamine. It came to me in a blinding flash. I had just finished my Ovaltine and switched off the lights when all of a sudden I started up in bed with a loud cry. Great Scott, I said, I've got it! And I began putting two and two together. And at 3 a.m, my brain fairly seething, I went to work on my crystal for a little. But it wasn't very satisfactory, cloudy, you know.
I would be very much obliged, Madame Arcati, if you would keep any theories you have regarding my wife's death to yourself.
Oh, my one desire is to help. I feel I've been dreadfully remiss in the whole affair. Well, not only remiss, but untidy.
I really do not think there's anything else that can be done.
Oh, but there is. I found a formula. Oh, here it is. I copied it out of Edmondson's Witchcraft and its Byways.
Oh, what the hell are you talking about?
Pluck up your heart, Mr. Condamine. All is not lost.
Now look here, Madame Arcati.
You are still anxious to dematerialize your first wife, I suppose?
Of course I am. I'm perfectly furious with her.
But what?
Well, she's been very upset the last few days. Aside from my being angry with her, which she always hated even when she was alive, my second wife, Ruth, has hardly left her side for a moment. So it's been quite difficult for her, what with one thing or another.
Your delicacy of feelings does you credit. But I must say, if you'll forgive my bluntness, that you are a damned fool, Mr. Condamine.
You're at liberty to think whatever you feel you want to.
No. Let's not get on our high horse. There's no need for that, is there? I have a formula here that I believe will get rid of her without hurting her feelings in the least. It's very simple, really. It's nothing more than a simple verse. All it needs is complete concentration from you and a minor trance from me. I might even be able to do it without lying down.
Now look, Madame Arcati, I really think that...
Charles?
What on earth's the matter?
Oh, what's she doing here?
She came to offer me her condolences.
Well, they should have been congratulations.
Oh, you're not to talk like that, Elvira. It's in the worst possible taste. Madame Arcati, allow me to introduce my first wife, Elvira.
How do you do?
Who?
In what part of the room is she at the moment?
She's moving about rather rapidly. I'll let you know when and if she settles.
She's the one who brought me here in the first place, isn't she?
Yes.
Well, please tell her to get me back again as soon as possible. I can't stand another minute in this house.
Really, Elvira, I'm surprised at you.
I don't care how surprised you are. I'm sick of the whole thing. I want to go home.
Now don't be childish, Elvira.
I'm not being childish. I mean it.
This is interesting. Very interesting. I smell ectoplasm strongly.
What a disgusting thing to say.
Oh, this is wonderful. Wonderful.
Oh, please, get her out of the room. I need to talk to you.
Just a moment, Madame Arcati.
Just a minute. I've almost made contact. I can sense the vibrations. Oh, this is magnificent.
Elvira, don't be a spoil sport. Give her a little bit of encouragement.
If you promise to get her out of the room.
All right.
Oh, yes, yes, again, again. This is first rate.
How's
it really
that?
Is first rate. Absolutely stunning.
I'm so glad you're pleased.
Oh, get rid of her. Ruth will be here any minute.
Madame Arcati, would you consider it frightfully rude of me if I asked you to step into the dining room for just a moment? My first wife would like to speak to me alone.
Oh, must I? It's so lovely being actually in the room with her.
Only for a few minutes, and I promise you she'll still be here when you return.
Very well. Could you hand me my bag? It's over there by the settee. Oh, you darling, you little darling. Oh.
How good is she really?
I don't know.
Do you think she can get me back again?
My dear child.
Oh, don't call me your dear child. It's smug and supercilious.
There's no need to be rude.
Oh, this has been... The whole thing has been a failure, a miserable, dreary farewell, and what high hopes I started out with.
You can't expect much sympathy from me. I'm perfectly aware that your highest hope was to murder me.
Oh, don't put it like that. It sounds so beastly.
It is beastly. It's one of the beastliest ideas I've ever heard of.
Oh, there was a time when you would have welcomed a chance to be with me forever and ever.
Your behavior has shocked me immeasurably, Elvira. I had no idea you were so unscrupulous.
Oh, Charles.
Stop your crying.
Oh, they're only ghost tears. They don't mean anything, but they're very painful.
You brought all this on yourself, you know.
Oh, that's right. Rub it in. It's only because I loved you. The silliest thing I did in my whole life was to love you. You were always unworthy of me.
That remark comes perilously near impertinence, Elvira.
Oh, I sat there on the other side day after day, just longing for you. Truly I did. All through your affair with that brassy-looking woman in the south of France, I went on loving you and thinking truly of you. And even when you married Ruth, I forgave you. And I tried to understand because deep down inside I thought that you loved me best. That's why I put in for a return visit. Filled out all those forms and waited around in drafty passageways for hours. Oh, if only you died before you met Ruth, everything might have been all right. She's absolutely ruined you. I hadn't been in the house a day before I realized that. Your books, they aren't a quarter as good as they used to be either.
That's absolutely untrue. And Ruth has helped me and encouraged me with my work, which is a damn sight more than you ever did.
It's probably what's wrong with it.
All you ever wanted to do is go to parties and enjoy yourself.
Why shouldn't I have fun? I died young, didn't I?
You needn't have died at all if you hadn't been idiotic enough to go out on the river with Guy Henderson and get soaked to the skin.
Oh. So we're back to Guy Henderson again, are we?
You behaved abominably with Guy Henderson, and there's no use pretending that you didn't.
Guy adored me. And besides, he was very attractive.
You swore to me that he didn't attract you in the least.
Oh, you'd have gone through the roof if I told you he did.
Did you have an affair with Guy Henderson?
I'd rather not discuss it with you, if you don't mind.
Answer me, did you or didn't you?
Of course I didn't.
You let him kiss you, though, didn't you?
How could I stop him? He was bigger than I was.
You swore to me.
Of course I did. You were always making scenes over nothing at all.
Nothing at all?
I don't believe you loved me a bit, really. I think it was just your beastly vanity.
You honestly believe it was my vanity that made me upset when you went out in the punt with Guy Henderson?
It was not a punt. It was a little launch.
I don't care if it was a three-masted schooner. You had no right to go.
You seem to forget why I went. You seem to forget that you spent the evening making sheep flies at that overblown harridan with the false pearls.
A woman in Cynthia Cheviot's position would hardly wear false pearls.
They were practically all she was wearing.
I'm pained to observe that your 7 years in the echoing vaults of eternity have in no way impaired your native vulgarity.
Oh, that's the remark of a pompous ass.
I see nothing to be gained from continuing this discussion.
You always used to say that when you were thoroughly worsted.
On looking back over our married years, Elvira, I see now with horrid clarity that they were nothing but a mockery.
You invite mockery, Charles. It's something in your personality, a sort of seedy grandeur.
Once and for all, Elvira.
You never suspected it, but I laughed at you from the altar to the grave. All your petty jealousies and your fuming and your fussing.
You, who are feckless and irresponsible and morally unstable, I realized it even before we left Budley Salterton.
Nobody but a monumental bore would have thought of a honeymoon in Budley Salterton.
What's the matter with Budley Salterton?
Oh, I was an eager young bride, Charles. I wanted glamour, music, and romance. Instead, I got a potted plant, 7 hours on a damp golf course, and a three-piece orchestra playing Merry England.
It's a pity you didn't tell me so at the time.
I did. You wouldn't listen. That's why I went out on the moors that day with Captain Bracekirtle. I was desperate.
You swore to me that you were going to see your aunt in Exmouth.
It was the moors.
With Captain Bracekirtle.
With Captain Bracekirtle.
I should have known. What a fool I was. What a blind fool. Did he make love to you?
Of course.
Oh, Elvira.
Only very discreetly. He was in the cavalry, you know.
The only thing I can say is I'm well rid of you.
Unfortunately, you're not.
Oh, yes, I am. You're dead and Ruth's dead. I shall go away. I shall sell this house, lock, stock, and barrel, and go away.
I shall have to follow you.
I shall go far away, a long way. I shall go to South America. You'd hate that. You always were such a bad traveler.
It can't be helped. I shall have to follow you. You called me back.
I did not call you back.
Well, somebody didn't. It's hardly likely to have been Ruth.
Nothing was further from my mind.
Nonsense. You were talking about me that evening before dinner.
I could have just as well been talking about Joan of Arc. Wouldn't have meant I wanted her to come and live with me.
Actually, she's quite a lot of fun.
Oh, we'll stick to the point.
When I think of what it would have been like if I'd succeeded in getting you to the other side, after all, it makes me shudder. Honestly, it does. It would have been nothing but bickering and squabbling forever and ever and ever. I swear, I'm better off with Ruth. At least she'll find her own set and she won't get in my way.
Oh, so I get in your way, do I?
Only because I was idiotic enough to imagine that you loved me, and I sort of felt sorry for you.
I'm sick of these insults. Please go away.
Oh, there's nothing I'd like better. I always believed in cutting my losses. That's why I died!
Of all the brazen sophistry!
Call that old girl in here and set her to work. I can't stand another minute in this house. I want to go home.
Oh, please don't snivel.
Call her in. She's got to get me out of this.
I totally agree. And the sooner the better. Madam Akaki, would you come back in now, please?
Is the darling still here?
Yes.
Where? Tell me where.
Over by the piano, blowing her nose.
Oh, you dear. Oh, you little dear.
Stop her fawning over me, Charles, or I shall break something.
Madam Akaki, Elvira and I have discussed the situation, and she wishes to go home immediately.
Home?
Wherever it is she came from.
You don't think she'd like to stay a few days longer while I try to get things a little more organized?
No, I want to go now.
I could come here and be with her. I could bring my crystal.
Oh, God forbid.
We are both agreed that she needs to go as soon as possible. Please make every effort. Strain every nerve. You mentioned a formula. What was it?
Well, if you insist.
I do most emphatically insist.
Oh, Charles.
Shut up.
I can't guarantee anything, you know. I'll do my best, but it may not work.
What is the formula?
Nothing more than a simple verse, really. It fell into disuse after the 17th century. I shall need some pepper and salt.
There's pepper and salt in the dining room. I shall get it.
I ought to, of course, have some shepherd's wort and a frog or two, but I think I can manage without. You won't be frightened, will you, my dear? It's absolutely painless.
Will this be enough?
Yes, I only need a little. Put it on the table, please. Now, let me see. Sprinkle it, will you, just a soup's on, right there in the middle.
Oh, this is going to be a complete failure. I can tell you that here now.
Now, some snapdragons out of that vase, please. There's a good chap.
Merlin does this sort of thing all the time at parties and bores us all stiff with it.
Here you are.
Thank you. Next, the gramophone. In the old days, of course, they used a zither or reed pipes, but we better have the same record we had before, I think.
Whatever you think best, Madam
Osaki. I'll get it.
Oh, if only that Mr. Emsworth from the Psychical Research Society could see this. Oh, he'd have a fit. He would, really. Don't start it yet, my dear. Now then, Mr. Condamine, if you would please sit at the table and place your hands downward on it. But don't put your fingers in the pepper. I shall switch off the lights myself. Oh, shucks! I'd nearly forgotten. One triangle, one half circle, and one dot. There.
This is a waste of time. She's a complete fake.
Anything's worth trying.
Oh, I'm as eager for this to succeed as you are. Don't make any mistakes about that. But I can lay you 10-1 that this is going to be a dead failure.
Now, if your wife would be so kind as to lie down on the sofa.
Go ahead, Elvira.
Oh, this is sheer nonsense. Don't blame me if I get the giggles.
Just concentrate. Think of nothing.
That's right. Quite right. Hands at your side. Legs extended. Breathe steadily. One, two. One, two. One, two. Is she comfortable?
Are you comfortable, Elvira?
No.
She's quite comfortable.
Good. I shall join you in a moment, Mr. Condamine. I might have to go into a slight trance, but if I do, pay no attention. Now first the music, and away we go. Lights! Hold on to yourself. Concentrate.
Oh, dear, it's the pepper.
Down.
Ghostly spectre, ghoul or fiend, nevermore be thou convened. Shepherd's wort and holy rite banish thee into the night.
What a disagreeable little verse.
Be quiet, Elvira.
Anyone there?
Is there anyone there? One rap for yes, two raps for no. Is there anyone there? Is that you, Daphne? Oh, this is good stuff. Daphne, Mrs. Condamine would like to return. Oh, Daphne, did you hear what I said? Can you help us, dear? Oh, hold tight, Mr. Condamine. It's trying to break away. Oh, oh, oh.
What's happening? Are you all right, Madam McCarty? Are you hurt, Madam McCarty?
Oh, she's in one of her damn trances again, and here I am as ever I was.
Wake up, for God's sake.
Oh, leave her be. She's having a whale of a time. If I ever do get back, I'm going to strangle that bloody little Daphne.
What happened?
Nothing at all.
Oh, yes, it did. I know that something happened.
You fell over, that's all that happened.
Is she still here?
Of course she is.
Oh. Something must have gone wrong.
Oh, make her do it properly. I'm sick of being messed about with.
She's doing her best, Elvira.
I know that something happened. I sensed it in my trance. I felt it. It shivered right through me.
Once and for all, Charles, what the hell does this mean?
Well, we've done all we can. I must say, I couldn't be more exhausted.
It will be daylight soon.
That clock has always irritated me.
It was a wedding present from Uncle Walter.
Who's Uncle Walter?
Elvira's.
Well, all I can say is that he might have chosen something a little more decorative.
If that were all you could say, Ruth, it would be a great comfort to us all.
You can be as rude as you like, Elvira. I don't mind a bit. As a matter of fact, I would be extremely surprised if you weren't.
Why?
The reply to that is really too obvious.
I wish you two would stop bickering for 1 minute.
This is quite definitely one of the most frustrating nights I have ever spent.
The reply to that is pretty obvious, too.
I'm sure I don't know what you mean.
Oh, skip it.
Now, look here, Elvira. If you and I have to stay together in this house indefinitely, and it looks unpleasantly likely, then we had better come to some sort of arrangement.
What sort of arrangement?
You're not going to stay indefinitely in this house.
With you, then. We shall have to be with you.
I don't see why. Why don't you take up a cottage somewhere?
You called us back.
I've explained to you until I'm black in the face that I did not call you back.
Madame Arcati said you did.
Madame Arcati's a muddling old fool.
Oh, I could have told you that in the first place.
I think you are behaving very shabbily, Charles.
I don't see what I did.
We all agreed that as Elvira and I are dead, it would be both right and proper for us to dematerialize again as soon as possible. That I admit. We have allowed ourselves to be subjected to the most humiliating hocus-pocus for hours and hours without complaining.
Without complaining?
We've stood up, we've lain down, we've concentrated. We've endured five seances. We've watched her fling herself in and out of trances until we're dizzy. And at the end of it all, we find ourselves exactly where we were at the beginning.
It's not my fault.
Be that as it may, the least you could do would be to admit failure gracefully and try to make the best of it. Your manners are boorish to a degree.
I'm just as exhausted as you are. I've had to endure all the damn table tapping and whatnot.
Well, if she can't get us back, she can't, and that's that. We'll have to think of something else.
No, anything else is unthinkable.
Oh, that's gratitude for you.
Gratitude?
Yes, for all the years Ruth and I have devoted to you. You should be ashamed of yourself.
What about all the years I've devoted to you?
Oh, nonsense. Ruth and I have waited on you hand and foot, haven't we, Ruth? You're exceedingly selfish, and you always were.
Then I fail to see why you were both so anxious to get back to me.
You called us back, and you've done nothing but try to get rid of us ever since we got here, hasn't you?
He certainly has.
And now, owing to your idiotic inefficiency, we find ourselves in the most mortifying position. Boston. We're neither fish, flesh, nor fowl, or whatever it is.
A good red herring?
No, it can't be.
Then why don't you do something about it? Why don't you go back on your own?
We can't. You know perfectly well we can't.
Surely there's someone on the other side who can help you.
How would I know? I've only been there a few days. Ask Elvira.
I've already told you it won't do any good if we got Cagliostro, Mesmer, Merlin, Gilderich, and the Black Douglas all in a row. They couldn't do a thing. The impetus has got to come from here. I'm afraid Charles doesn't want us gone quite enough.
Oh, I most certainly do.
Then you have a very weak will. I always suspected it.
It's no use arguing anymore. Wake up, Madame Arcot.
Oh, not another seance, please. Not another seance.
Wake up, Madame Arcotti.
Shake her.
It might upset her.
I don't care if it kills her.
Wake up, Madame Arcotti.
What time is it?
5:10.
What time did I go off?
Over an hour ago.
Very curious. Forgive me for a moment, but I must make a note of this in my diary. Are they still here?
Of course they are.
Oh, how disappointing.
Do you have any suggestions?
We mustn't give up hope. Chin up. Never give in. That's my motto.
Oh, that schoolgirl phraseology is driving me mad.
Now then.
Now then what?
What do you say if we have another seance and really put our shoulders to the wheel? Make it a real rouser. Oh, for God's sakes, not another seance. I might even be able to materialize a trumpet if I tried hard enough. Better than nothing, you know. I feel fit as a fiddle after my trance. I don't care if she materializes an entire symphony orchestra. I implore you, not another seance.
Don't you think, Madame Arcotti, that we've had quite enough seances? I mean, they haven't achieved much of anything, have they?
Rome wasn't built in a day, you know.
No, it wasn't, but...
Well, then, cheer up. Away with melancholy.
Before you go off into any other trances, I really think that we ought to discuss the matter a bit.
Good. Excellent idea. And while we're doing it, I think I'll have one of those delicious sandwiches. Oh, I'm as hungry as Hunter after my rest.
Would you like another beer?
No, thank you. Better not.
I think I'll have a small whiskey and soda.
Make it a double and enjoy yourself.
One day I intend to give myself the pleasure of telling Madame Arcotti exactly what I think of her.
She's been doing her best.
Oh, are the girls getting despondent?
I'm afraid they are, rather.
Oh, we'll win through yet. Don't be downhearted.
If we're not very careful, she'll materialize a hockey team.
Now then, Mr. Condamine, the discussion.
My wives and I have discussed the situation, and they are absolutely convinced that I somehow or other called them back.
Very natural.
And I am absolutely convinced that I did not.
Love is a strong psychic force, Mr. Condamine. It can work untold miracles. A true love call can encompass the universe.
I'm sure it can, Madame Arcotti. But I must confess to you truthfully that although my affection for both Elvira and Ruth was of the warmest, I don't believe that it would fall under the heading that you have described.
I should just think not, indeed. You may not be aware of your own strength, Mr. Condamine.
I did not bring them back, either consciously or subconsciously.
But, Mr. Condamine...
That's my final word on the matter.
Neither of them could have appeared unless someone, a psychic subject in this house, had wished for them.
Well, it wasn't me.
Perhaps it was Dr. Bradman. I never knew he cared. Are you sure? Are you really sure?
Absolutely positive.
Great Scott! I believe I've been barking up the wrong tree!
What are you referring to?
The Sudbury case.
I don't understand.
Oh, there's no reason why you should. It was before your day. I wonder.
What was the Sudbury case? I wish you'd explain.
It was the case that made me famous, Mr. Condamine. It was what might be described in theatrical parlance as my first smash hit. I had letters from all over the world about it, especially India.
What did you do?
I dematerialized old Lady Sudbury after she had been firmly entrenched in the private chapel for 17 years.
How did you do it? Do you remember?
Oh, it was a fluke. By chance, I happened upon it by the merest coincidence.
What fluke? What was it?
Wait. All in good time. Now then. Who was in the house when we had our first seance?
Only the Bradmans, Ruth, and me, and yourself.
Yes, to be sure.
But the Bradmans weren't here last night, were they?
No.
Quickly, my crystal! Oh, damn thing gives me the pip. It's cloudy again. Oh, that's better. Oh, it's there again. It's there again. I'm beginning to understand.
I wish I was. What's there again?
A bandage. A white bandage. Hold on to a white bandage.
I haven't got a white bandage.
Shh. She's too good shot to be in the circus, you know.
Be you in nook or cranny, answer me. Be you in still room or closet, answer me. Be you behind the panels, above the stairs, beneath the eaves, waking or sleeping, answer me. That ought to do it, or I'm a Dutchman.
Do what?
Oh, wait, one more time.
Oh, for God's sake, don't let her throw any more of that garlic about. It nearly made me sick last time.
Would you like the gramophone on or the lights off?
Oh, no, no. It's near. It's really near.
If it's a ghost, I shall scream.
I certainly hope it's nobody we know. I shall feel so silly.
Did you ring, sir?
Oh, the bandage! The white bandage!
No, Edith.
I could have sworn I heard the bell or somebody calling, but it was...
Come here, child.
I was
It's all
asleep.
Right. Go to Madame Arcadia.
Whom do you see in this room, child?
Oh, dear.
Answer, please.
You, madam.
Go on.
A master.
Anyone else?
Oh, no, madam.
Look again.
I don't understand.
Come, child. Don't beat about the bush. Look again.
Oh, be still, Elvira, and do concentrate.
I can't. Do you see anyone else now?
Oh, no, madam.
She's lying.
Oh, madam.
Oh, they always do.
They?
Where are they now?
By the fireplace.
Aha!
Oh, she can see them? You mean she can see them?
Probably not very clearly, but enough.
Let me go back to bed. I haven't done nothing wrong or seen nobody.
It's
Let me
all
go
right.
back.
It's all right. Nobody's
I don't
sandwich.
Want a sandwich. Oh, help me go back to bed.
A healthy girl like you saying no to a delicious sandwich?
Oh, please,
why, I
sir,
never heard of such a thing. Sit down, please.
I haven't done nothing wrong.
It's okay. No one said you had. Do what Madame Arcati says.
If she's been the cause of all this unpleasantness, I shall give her a week's notice tomorrow.
You may not be
Look
here
at
tomorrow.
My finger, Edith. Cuckoo, cuckoo, cuckoo.
Oh, dear, what's the matter with her? Is she balmy?
Edith, look at my finger. Have you ever seen such a long, long finger? Look, now it's on the right. Now it's on the left. Backwards and forwards it goes. Very quietly, backwards and forwards. Tick, tock, tick, tock, tick, tock.
The mouse ran up the clock.
Be still, you'll ruin everything.
So far, so good. She's off all right.
Off?
She's a natural. It's just the same as the Sudbury case. It really is the most amusing coincidence. Now then, Mr. Condamine, will you have your wives stand close together, please?
Where?
Over there by you.
Elvira? Ruth?
I resent being ordered about like this.
I don't like any of this. I don't like it at all. I feel peculiar.
I'm afraid I must insist.
It would serve you right if we flatly refused to do anything at all.
Are you sorry for having been so mischievous, Edith?
Oh, yes, madam.
You know what you must do now, then, don't you, Edith?
Oh, yes, madam.
I think it's beginning to work, whatever it is. Oh, Charles!
Shh!
This is goodbye, Charles!
Stop her a minute. There's something I want to say before we go.
I should have thought of that before. It's too late
oh,
now.
Oh, mean it!
Listen a moment, Charles!
Oh, Charles. I saw Captain Brayskettle again several times. I went to the 400 with him twice when you were in Nottingham. And I must say, I have never enjoyed myself more.
Don't think you're getting rid of us quite so easily, my dear. We shall be here all right, even though you may not be able to see us. And I think you have behaved atrociously through the whole miserable business. And I should like to say here and
now. Hurrah! Splendid! We've done it! That's quite enough singing for the moment, Edith.
They're gone. They've really gone.
Yes, I think we really pulled it off this time.
Perhaps you'd better wake up Edith or she'll bring them back again.
Wake up, Edith. Oh, good heavens, where am I?
It It's all right, Edith. You can go back up to bed now.
Why? It's morning.
Yes, I know it is.
But I was in bed. How did I get here?
I rang, Edith. I rang the bell and you answered, didn't I, Madame McCarthy?
Oh, dear, did I drop off? Is it my concussion?
Off with you now, Edith.
Oh.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much indeed.
Oh, dear, whatever for? Oh, shit!
What do you suppose she meant by that?
Golly, what a night! I'm ready to drop in my tracks.
Perhaps you'd like to stay here. There's the spare room, you know.
No, thank you. Everyone to his own nest. I'll pedal home in a jiffy. It's only 7 miles.
I'm deeply grateful to you, Madame Arcati. I don't know what your practice normally is, but I assume you'll send in your account in due course.
Oh, good heavens, Mr. Condamine. It was my pleasure. I wouldn't dream of such a thing.
But, Madame Arcati, all those trances and everything?
I enjoy them, Mr. Condamine, thoroughly. Always have since a child.
Well, perhaps you'll do me the pleasure of lunching with me one day soon.
When you come back, I should be delighted.
Come back?
Take my advice, Mr. Condamine, and go away immediately.
You don't mean...
This must be an unhappy house for you. There must be memories, both grave and gay, in every corner of it. And also...
Also what?
There are more things in heaven and earth, Mr. Condamine. Take my advice, pack your traps, and go away as fast as you can.
Do you mean they might still be here?
Quién sabe, as the Spanish say.
I wonder... I wonder. Well, I'll follow your advice, Madame Arcati. Thank you again.
Well, goodbye, Mr. Condamine. It has been fascinating from first to last. Fascinating. Would you mind if I have one of those sandwiches to take for the ride home?
By all means.
Don't trouble, I can find my way. Cheerio once more, and good hunting.
Thank you. Ruth? Elvira? Are you there? Ruth? Elvira? I know damned well you're there. I just want to tell you that I'm going away, so there's no reason for you to hang about any longer. I'm going a long way away, somewhere where I don't think you'll be able to follow me. In spite of what Elvira said, I don't think that spirits can travel over water. Is that perfectly clear, my darlings? You said in one of your more acid moments, Ruth, that I've been hag-ridden all my life. How right you were. But now I'm free, Ruth, dear. Not only of Mother and Elvira and Mrs. Winthrop Llewellyn, but free of you, too. And I want to take this farewell opportunity to say that I'm enjoying it immensely. Aha! I thought so. You were very silly, Elvira, to think I didn't know all about you and Captain Bracegirdle. I did. But what you didn't know is I was extremely attached to Paula Westlake at the time. And I was reasonably faithful to you, Ruth, but I doubt that it would have lasted much longer. You were becoming increasingly domineering, and there's nothing more off-putting than that, is there? So it's goodbye for now, my darlings. I expect we'll meet again one day, and until we do, I intend to enjoy myself as I've never enjoyed myself before. You can tear up the house all you want, my dears. I'm leaving it anyway. Think kindly of me and send good thoughts. Nice work, Ruth. Get Elvira to help you. Persevere. Goodbye again. Parting is such sweet sorrow.